morning, everyone. Can I welcome you to the sixth meeting in 2016 of the Infrastructure and Capital Investment Committee. Everyone present is reminded to switch off mobile phones as they affect the broadcasting system. As meeting papers are provided in digital format, you may see tablets being used during the meeting. Apologies have been received from Siobhan McMahon, but we are expecting James Kelly to attend as a substitute later this morning. The first item on the agenda is to take evidence on the Draft Letting Agent Code of Practice, Scotland Regulations 2016. I welcome Margaret Burgess, Minister for Housing and Welfare, Charlotte McHaffie, Senior Policy Officer, Private Rented Sector Regulation Team, and Jackie Pantony, Principal Legal Officer at the Scottish Government. Good morning. This instrument is laid under affirmative procedure, which means that the Parliament must approve it before the provisions can come into force. Following this evidence session, the committee will be invited at the next agenda item to consider a motion to approve the instrument. Can I invite the Minister to make a short opening statement?
Yeah, thank you, Convener. I welcome the opportunity to give evidence in the Draft Letting Agent Code of Practice, Scotland Regulations 2016. The private rented sector plays an increasingly important role in meeting housing need across Scotland. Because letting agents manage roughly half of all annual lettings, letting agents are well positioned to improve standards in the sector by ensuring the homes they let are of good quality and well managed. And many letting agents operate in a professional manner, but this good practice is not shared by all. The draft code is intended to rectify this by setting out the standards of practice that all letting agents must meet. The key features of the code include a clear framework that has been structured to follow the letting process, making it easy for letting agents, landlords and tenants to navigate, a requirement on letting agents not to act for landlords who are refusing or unreasonably delaying complying with their legal obligations, and to inform the relevant authorities. And this will help enforce standards, and a requirement for letting agents to hold client money protection and professional indemnity insurance, providing additional protection for landlords and tenants if things go wrong. In drafting the regulations, we have drawn on existing voluntary codes of practice and related documents, worked with industry bodies as well as housing and tenant groups, and held a public consultation, and as far as possible, future-proof the document to avoid it becoming out of date in the immediate future, for example, due to changes in the Private Housing Tenancies Scotland Bill. Importantly, the code gives consumers and Scottish ministers the ability to challenge poor practice by agents through the first-tier tribunal. By providing consumers with a more accessible form of redress, landlords and tenants will be in a better position to assert their rights, which should in turn encourage agents to make improvements in their services. Scottish ministers will also be able to take breaches of the code into account in determining whether a letting agent should be permitted to or permitted to remain on the mandatory register of letting agents that ministers are required to establish. Ultimately, a letting agent who fails to comply with the code may be removed from the register, which would mean that they would no longer be able to operate. And I believe this code will support positive changes in the letting industry. Thank you.
Minister, I now invite members to ask any questions they have. Are there any questions from members? It would appear that the members of the committee are satisfied with your opening statement, Minister. In that case, can I thank the Minister and her officials for their evidence. The second agenda item is the formal consideration of motion S4M 15460, calling for the committee to recommend approval of the Draft Letting Agent Code of Practice Scotland Regulations 2016. I invite the Minister to speak to and move motion 64M-15460.
I move that the S4M-15460, that the Infrastructure and Capital Investment Committee recommends that the Letting Agent Code of Practice Scotland Regulations 2016 be approved.
Thank you. I now invite any further comments and questions from members. There are no further comments or questions. In that case, the question is that motion S4M-15460 in the name of Margaret Burgess be approved. Are we all agreed?
Agreed.
We are agreed. In that case, that concludes the consideration of this affirmative instrument. We will report the outcome of our consideration to the Parliament. And I will now suspend briefly to allow for a witness changeover. Capital Investment Committee. Our next agenda item is to consider the Private Housing Tenancies Scotland Bill at Stage 2. We have a large number of Scottish Government and non-government amendments to consider, and we hope to make as much progress as we can in disposing of these today. The committee will have an opportunity to complete consideration of amendments on the 24th of February if further time is necessary. Can I welcome back Margaret Burgess, Minister for Housing and Welfare, and her supporting officials. I remind members that the Minister's officials are here in a strictly supportive capacity and cannot speak during Stage 2 proceedings or be questioned by members. Members should have a copy of the bill, the marshalled list and the groupings for today's consideration. The question is that Section 1 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? Okay. Schedule 1 is for us to consider the meaning of private residential tenancy. I call Amendment 1 in the name of the Minister, grouped with Amendments 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 80 and 102. And I call on the Minister to move Amendment 1 and speak to all amendments in the group.
Okay, thank you, Convener. I will speak to Amendments numbers 1 to 17, 80 and 102. These amendments amend Schedule 1 of the Bill, which outlines the types of tenancies that cannot be private residential tenancies. The Scottish Government recognises that the recent growth of purpose-built student accommodation now provides much-needed new accommodation for students and has been developed for the specific purpose of providing bespoke accommodation. This is similar in character to the accommodation that colleges and universities provide, which is exempt from the provisions of the Bill and does not form part of the mainstream PRS. In responding to the committee's Stage 1 report, I said that I would bring forward an amendment that will have the effect of exempting purpose-built student accommodation properties from the Bill. Amendment 9 is designed to do just this. Amendment 9 extends the existing student let exemption to include purpose-built student accommodation. Amendments 1 to 8 make some minor consequential changes to the existing exemption as a result. The effect of Amendment 9 is that the tenancies offered by PBSA providers will not be private residential tenancies. Among other things, this will ensure that PBSA providers can continue to provide accommodation for students through their nomination agreements with colleges and universities. In order to do this, they need to be able to order fixed-term tenancies so that they know what properties will be available for the next academic year, well in advance of it beginning. Schedule 3 of the Bill lists the eviction grounds under which landlords can regain possession of their property. One of the grounds is that the tenant is not a student, which was included with PBSA providers in mind. Amendment 102 removes this eviction ground, and this ground will no longer be relevant if PBSA providers are to be exempt from the new tenancy regime, or if to be removed altogether from it, which I believe is the most appropriate approach. Amendment 80 makes a consequential amendment to Section 37 of the Bill to remove the reference to the eviction ground of not a student. If Amendment 102 is accepted, this eviction ground will no longer apply. Amendments 10 to 15 clarify what is meant by resident landlord in Schedule 1. The effect of Amendments 10 and 11 is to confirm that where a tenant moves into a shared flat with the landlord, this cannot be a private residential tenancy. Amendments 12 and 14 simply change the location of what is currently paragraph 9 of Schedule 1, as it will not be relevant to the new text being inserted by Amendments 10 and 11. At the same time, a minor change is made to the reference to an executor to avoid any confusion in a case where an executor is also a beneficiary. Amendments 13 and 15 are minor consequential amendments to update paragraph references. Amendment 16 excludes those tenancies where the landlord is the Scottish Police Authority. Police Scotland has housing for officers mainly in rural areas so that they are able to fulfil their operational requirements. This amendment will enable Police Scotland to continue to move their officers around the country and to provide housing for them where this is required. Amendment 17 adds an exemption for the Ministry of Defence. The effect of this amendment will be that the MOD will be able to maintain its operational effectiveness in deploying its personnel across Scotland. I move Amendment 1.
Thank you, Minister. Call Alec Johnson.
Thank you very much, Convener. Can I begin by saying I welcome the amendments in this grouping. With regard to the changes in student accommodation, there are a couple of minor points I'd like the Minister's views on. Firstly, there is, I believe, no provision here for accommodation to become, which is currently private rented, to become student accommodation. Is it deliberate that you're sticking to purpose-built student accommodation, or could you envisage accommodation transferring from one purpose to another where need is identified, including change of planning permission for HMOs, for example, or other means? Secondly, can I ask if the Minister is content that the bill adequately defines what a student is and whether it's anticipated that any closer examination of that definition might be necessary?
I think in answer to your first point, we've been clear that we're talking here about purpose-built student accommodation that have nomination rights with universities. We will define in legislation later what we would include in purpose-built student accommodation. In terms of the definition of student, I think we're satisfied that we've got that right in the bill.
Thank you.
Thank you. I generally accept the amendments that the Minister has moved. However, could you ask that the Minister looks carefully at, in the future, having a review of student accommodation and perhaps makes a commitment to ensure that students renting from this type of accommodation are not charged pre-tenancy fees and are protected by the repairing standard under Section 13 of the Housing Scotland Act 2006.
Can I ensure that all members who want to speak have spoken before you wind up, if that's okay. Are there any other members who have any other points they wish to make on this group of amendments? In that case, I invite the Minister to wind up.
I think in response to David Stewart, we'd clearly have made a commitment that we will be reviewing the whole of how this bill, if and when passes, how it is working for the student sector, both in the purpose-built student accommodation and in the wider private rented sector. And currently, just now, there are students in the purpose-built sector who are in short assured tenancies, and some are on occupancy rights through the university standards, and they have to have standards, and we would anticipate that would continue, but we'll certainly be taking that on board what you say as we move forward.
The question is that Amendment 1 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are agreed. Call Amendments 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16 and 17, all in the name of the Minister and all previously debated. Can I invite the Minister to move Amendments 2 to 17 on block?
Moved on block.
Thank you. Can I ask whether any member objects to a single question being put on Amendments 2 to 17? Okay. In that case, the question is that Amendments 2 to 17 are agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are. Thank you. The question is that Schedule 1 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are. The question is that Sections 2 to 4 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? Thank you. The next group of amendments concerns the statutory terms of tenancy. I call Amendment 150 in the name of David Stewart, grouped with Amendments 151, 18, 19 and 20. And I invite David Stewart to move Amendment 150 and speak to all amendments in the group.
Thank you, Convener. I'd like to move Amendment 150, the statutory terms of tenancy. So the purpose of my amendment is to ensure that statutory terms cannot be contracted out of. And generally, I would say this applies for all my amendments, Convener, that amendments are supported by Shelter Scotland, CAS, Government Law Centre, Living Rent Campaign, Crisis and NUS. And unless otherwise stated in the future this morning, all the amendments I'm moving will be supported by all these organisations that I've mentioned. So I'd like to introduce Amendment 150 and clarify what is in the bill. It will ensure that any terms put into lease by a landlord which are contrary to the statutory terms will have no legal standing with the tribunal should a landlord attempt to enforce them, even if the tenant has signed the lease. This would give tenants clear and unambiguous protection against any terms introduced by the landlord which undermine their rights. So effectively what this does, it stops an undermining of security of tenure. I move the amendment, Convener.
Thank you. Thank you. I now invite Adam Ingram to speak to Amendment 151 and other amendments in the group.
Thank you, Convener. I'll speak exclusively on Amendment 151. The purpose of this amendment seeks to make the duty to inform a landlord about others staying in the property more proportionate. As initially drafted, the tenant would, the legislation, the bill would be obliged to send their landlord details of every person who stayed in the property, even if it was just a friend staying overnight. This would represent unreasonable intrusion into the lives of the tenant. Indeed, as currently drafted, the tenant might be in material breach of the tenancy and liable to eviction for failing to notify the landlord that someone had stayed for a day or two. Whilst the aim of this particular paragraph in the bill is welcome, in giving landlords the power to prevent overcrowding and subletting, the simple technical amendment which specifies that the additional person is living in the accommodation as their main home renders the paragraph more proportionate.
Thank you. I now invite the Minister to speak to Amendment 18 and other amendments in the group.
Okay, thank you, Convener. Schedule 2 of the bill already provides that it is to be a statutory term of every private residential tenancy that the tenant is to tell the landlord about anyone aged 16 or over who resides in the property. Amendment 18 will ensure it's also a statutory term of tenancies that the tenant tells the landlord if the person subsequently ceases to reside in the property. The purpose of Amendment 18 is to ensure landlords know how many people are living with their tenants so that landlords can manage their properties, for example, as was said, by ensuring there is no overcrowding. Schedule 2 of the bill outlines some of the terms which will be laid down in regulations as statutory terms of the private residential tenancy. One of the terms which the regulations must include is that a tenant must allow the landlord or any person authorised by the landlord reasonable access to the property to carry out work or to inspect the property in order to determine what work, if any, to carry out, except where access is required urgently. The landlord must provide the tenant with at least 48 hours' notice that this access is required. Amendments 19 and 20 reframe the obligations relating to access in order to make it clear that the tenant can waive the 48 hours' notice if the tenant is content to do so. However, other than where access is required urgently, there is no obligation on the tenant to allow access if he or she has not received this notice. The effect of this is to provide more flexibility where both parties are in agreement. With regard to David Stewart's Amendment 150, there is no need to provide this for this in the bill, as it is already implicit that landlords and tenants cannot contract out of the statutory terms. Section 5.2 of the bill states that the statutory terms are terms of every private residential tenancy. This is also why Section 12.4 talks about a contractual term purporting to displace a statutory term rather than talking about it actually doing so. And I understand there's been a suggestion that it would be simpler for these terms to apply automatically rather than the tenant needing to go to the tribunal in order to have them apply. But let me be clear, a tenant does not need to make an application to the tribunal in order for the terms to apply. They apply automatically. But if a tenant wants to see how a statutory term fits alongside other contractual lease terms, he or she should be able to ask for a document which does this. So I'm happy to clarify this, and I hope it gives Mr. Stewart the reassurance he seeks. However, there may be cases where including the provision suggested in this amendment could lead to difficulties. Section 5.3 of the bill provides a power for Scottish ministers to allow the effect of the statutory terms to be modified or displaced by the parties in certain circumstances. For example, where a protection is enhanced by the parties in a way that is in the tenant's interests. The amendment, as proposed, may cause confusion in such cases, as there could be a question mark over whether the modification is a statutory or contractual term. And I would therefore urge David Stewart not to press his amendment. With regard to Adam Ingram's amendment 151, Schedule 2 sets out the statutory terms that are provided for on the face of the bill. This includes notification about other residents about whom the tenant must inform the landlord if they're residing in the property. This is so the landlord knows how many adults are living with the tenant so that they're able to effectively manage their property. Amendment 151 limits the statutory term so that a tenant need only tell the landlord about a person aged 16 or over residing in the property if it's that person's only or principal home. And I think this is a sensible approach, and I'm content to accept the member's amendment in principle. However, I consider the drafting to be defective and would ask Adam Ingram to withdraw this amendment and allow me to bring forward an amendment at stage 3 which has the same purpose and effect, and I would ask him not to press it at this stage.
No other members have indicated they wish to speak on this group of amendments. Therefore, I would now ask David Stewart to wind up and to indicate whether he wishes to press or withdraw his amendment.
Thank you, Convener. I hear what the Minister says, and we'd ask that the Minister looks at this particular amendment in Stage 3 so we can look at this issue again.
Okay, I take it, therefore, that you're not...
I'm not pressing.
..to move.
Yeah.
Can I ask if members are content for that amendment to be withdrawn?
Are members content for that amendment to be withdrawn? Members are. The question is that Amendment 150 be agreed to... Okay, the question is that Section 5 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Question is that Section 6 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? Okay, I now call Amendment 151 in the name of Adam Ingram, already debated with Amendment 150. I would ask Adam Ingram to move or not move.
Can I withdraw that amendment?
Okay, not moved. I now call Amendments 18, 19 and 20, all in the name of the Minister and all previously debated. Can I invite the Minister to move Amendments 18 to 20 on block? Okay, can I ask whether any member objects to a single question being put on Amendments 18 to 20? Okay, in that case, the question is that Amendments 18 to 20 are agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are agreed. The question is that Schedule 2 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? The question is that Section 7 to 11 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? Okay. The next group of amendments relates to technical drafting and consequential amendments. I call Amendment 21 in the name of the Minister, grouped with Amendments 22, 23, 24, 25, 26, 27, 28, 29, 42, 56, 83, 129, 134, 139, 140 and 141. Can I ask the Minister to move Amendment 21 and speak to all amendments in the group?
Okay. Amendment 24 joins up the process of a tenant applying for a written tenancy agreement with the process of applying for an order for payment against the landlord to ensure that a tenant does not go away with a financial award, but still without any written terms for his or her tenancy. Section 14 enables a tenant to apply to the tribunal to make an order against a landlord who has failed to provide the tenant with the necessary tenancy information, including any written terms of the tenancy which are required under Section 8. An order can require the landlord to pay the tenant up to a maximum of 3 months' rent. Amendment 24 ensures that where the terms of the tenancy are not set out in writing between the parties, an application for a payment order under Section 14 can only be made in conjunction with an application to the tribunal to draw up written terms under Section 12. Amendment 56, I'll talk to now, is where a tenant disputes a landlord's proposed rent increase. The bill provides for how the rent officer or the tribunal is to calculate the open market rent of the property. The provisions state that this should include an assumption that the property has been let by a willing landlord. The law assumes that a willing tenant is implied in any calculation of open market rent. However, for the avoidance of any doubt, Amendment 56 states explicitly that there is also an assumption that the property has been let to a willing tenant. This is something that the Law Society of Scotland called for as part of their Stage 1 evidence to the committee. Amendments 139 and 140, I'll speak to. Section 61 sets out definitions for a number of terms used throughout the bill and includes, amongst other things, a definition of rent. Amendment 139 confirms that rent means any sums paid periodically by the tenant to the landlord rather than payments of a one-off nature. and Amendment 140 clarifies that rent includes sums payable in respect of services, repairs, maintenance or insurance. Payments of this nature are included to ensure that sums cannot be charged which fall out with the definition of rent in a way which would undermine the protections we are introducing in relation to rent increases. Amendment 141. Now, the bill contains amendments to other acts which refer to the day that Section 1 comes into force. For now, this is unavoidable because the actual date of Section 1 coming into force is to be set by later regulations. The amendments in their present form will put those reading the amended acts to the trouble of having to find the commencement regulations to see what day Section 1 was actually brought into force. To make life easier for those looking at the amended acts online or in updated printed versions, Amendment 141 will allow regulations to insert the actual date that Section 1 comes into force. Similarly, the amendment will allow regulations to remove Section 6(5) with effect from the day that Section 1 comes into force, because on that day, Section 6(5), which applies only before Section 1 comes into force, will become irrelevant. Okay, amendments 21 to 23, 25 to 29, 42, 83, 129 and 134 fix minor drafting points. I move amendment 21.
Thank you, Minister. No members have indicated they wish to speak on this group of amendments. Can I therefore ask you to wind up?
Nothing else to add, convener.
Thank you. In that case, the question is that Amendment 21 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The question is that Section 12 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The question is that Section 13 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
I call Amendments 22, 23, 24 and 25, all in the name of the Minister and all previously debated. I invite the Minister to move Amendments 22 to 25 en bloc.
Moved en bloc.
Thank you. Can I ask whether any member objects to a single question being put on Amendments 22 to 25? In that case, the question is that Amendments 22 to 25 are agreed to. Are we all agreed? We are agreed. The question is that Section 14 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? I call Amendments 26, 27, 28 and 29, all in the name of the Minister and all previously debated. I invite the Minister to move Amendments 26 to 29 en bloc. Thank you. I ask whether any member objects to a single question being put on Amendments 26 to 29. In that case, the question is that Amendments 26 to 29 are agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are agreed. The question is that Section 15 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The question is that Section 16 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Okay, the next section of next group of amendments are those concerning the effective date of rent increase notice. I call Amendment 30 in the name of the Minister, grouped with Amendments 32, 33, 34, 35, 40, 41, 43, 44, 45, 46, 47, 48, 49, 50, 51, 52 and 55. And I invite the Minister to move Amendment 30 and speak to all amendments in the group.
The Convener, I'll speak to Amendment numbers 30, 32, 35 to 35, 40, 41, 43 to 52 and 55. Section 19 of the bill provides that a landlord must give a tenant at least 3 months' notice before the landlord can increase the rent. Amendment 33 reconfigures how this rent increase notice takes effect. The result of the change is that if a tenant receives a notice which fails to give enough time, perhaps due to unexpected postal delays, the notice can still take effect, but not until the 3 months notice period has elapsed from the actual date of receipt by the tenant. Adopting this approach provides a fallback position for cases where there are unexpected delays in a tenant receiving the notice. However, in the vast majority of cases, the rent increase notice will, unless it's disputed, simply take effect on the date specified. Amendments 30, 32, 34, 35, 40, 41, 43 to 52 and 55 are consequential amendments made as a result of the reconfiguration. The overall effect is that neither party will end up in an unclear position where the validity of a rent increase notice is in doubt, but the tenant is always guaranteed the protection of a minimum of 3 months' notice of any increase. I move Amendment 30.
Thank you. No members have indicated they wish to speak. Oh, sorry, my apologies. Alec Johnson.
Just a very brief question that comes from the Minister's explanation. How will you confirm receipt of a rent increase notice?
There are regulations about when a notice is received, when it's sent by special delivery. There are that is laid down in, not less in the bill, but it's laid down in the Interpretation Act, I'm getting told to you. So there is a legal definition of when someone receives a notice.
Yes, thank you.
Yep.
Any further points from members? Do you have anything further you wish to add, Minister?
Nothing further to add.
Okay, in that case, the question is that Amendment 30 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? The question is that Section 17 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? The question is that Section 18 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? Okay, the next group is an amendment on restriction on diligence. And I call Amendment 31 in the name of the Minister and a group on its own. And I call on the Minister to move and speak to Amendment 31.
Okay. Convener, I'll speak to Amendment 31. This amendment introduces a restriction on the debt recovery action that a landlord can take against a tenant for unpaid rent. It also applies to a liability which arises under Section 26 of the Bill as a result of a rent increase. The amendment ensures that a landlord can only carry out diligence against a tenant for outstanding liabilities of this nature if the landlord has first obtained the consent of the first-tier tribunal. This protects the tenant by ensuring that all relevant circumstances can be considered before any diligence is allowed to proceed. It mirrors the effect of a similar protection which exists in assured tenancies under the Housing Scotland Act 1988. And I move Amendment 31.
Thank you, Minister. Do members have any contributions? No. In that case, do you have anything further to add, Minister? Fine, thank you. The question is that Amendment 31 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? I call Amendments 32, 33, 34 and 35, all in the name of the Minister and all previously debated. I invite the Minister to move Amendments 32 to 35 on block.
Moved on block.
Thank you. Can I ask whether any member objects to a single question being put on Amendments 32 to 35?
No.
Thank you. In that case, the question is that Amendments 32 to 35 are agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are agreed. Now move on to amendments relating to modification of rent increase notice. I call Amendment 36 in the name of the Minister, grouped with Amendments 37, 38 and 39. And I invite the Minister to move Amendment 36 and speak to all amendments in the group.
Okay. I'll speak to Amendments number 36 to 39, Convener. As I said when discussing Group 4 earlier, Section 19 of the Bill provides that a landlord must give a tenant at least 3 months' notice before the landlord can increase the rent. Amendments 36 to 39 relate to the landlord's and tenant's ability to modify the date or amount in the rent increase notice by agreement. This is designed to allow the parties to reach a compromise if they wish to do so, while still ensuring that they cannot bring forward the date of the increase and shorten the original 3 months' notice period given to the tenant. Provisions to this effect have been in the Bill since introduction, but they are now moved to a section on their own for accessibility. The amendments also clarify that where the rent is subsequently referred to a rent officer for adjudication, the modification will be both void for both the rent officer's and the tribunal's purposes. I move Amendment 36.
Thank you, Minister. No members indicated they wish to speak. Do you have anything further to add?
Nothing further.
Thank you, Minister. The question is that Amendment 36 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Agreed.
The question is that Section 19 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Agreed.
Call Amendment 37 in the name of the Minister, already debated with Amendment 36. And I invite the Minister to move formally.
Moved.
Thank you. The question is that Amendment 37 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
I call Amendment 38 in the name of the Minister, already debated with Amendment 36, and I invite the Minister to formally move.
Moved.
Thank you. The question is that Amendment 38 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are agreed. Thank you. The next group refers to tenants' right to defer rent. I call Amendment 152 in the name of David Stewart, grouped with Amendment 153. And I invite David Stewart to move Amendment 152 and speak to both amendments in the group.
Thank you, Convener. These amendments refer to a tenant's right to refer rent. The bill as currently drafted does not allow a tenant to refer the rent to a rent officer until they received a rent increase notice from their landlord. That means that tenants who sign up to rent a property with a vastly inflated rent are not able to challenge this until they receive the notice of an increase. Tenants who are not familiar with the local area market rents may be particularly vulnerable to this, for example, migrant workers and foreign students. The amendment also allows tenants who are living in a rent pressure zone to defer their rent to a rent officer. The bill as currently drafted does not allow for this, and it would seem unfair that tenants who are already paying above market rents, even though they are in a rent pressure zone, are not able to seek recourse to fix a market rent. I hope members can support these amendments 152 and 153 to ensure that level playing field for all tenants when it comes to ensuring all tenants pay no more than the local market rate for their home.
Thank you. Mr. Kelly.
Can I, Convener, if I'd like to speak in support of David Stewart's both motions. I think it's important that tenants have an expectation that rents are set at a fair level. And it's, as well as that, that's linked to the fact that, you know, it can be correct that people may be trying to unfairly, you know, profit in certain areas. And I think what this does is it ensures a level of fairness by allowing someone who feels that the level of rent being set is not on a par with what the local market rent is, and it allows that for referral and further review. So I think these are sensible amendments that seek to underline the importance of fair rents.
Thank you. Do any other members wish to speak on this amendment? No. In that case, can I invite the Minister to respond?
I'll respond to David Stewart's amendments 152 and 153. Section 20 of the bill provides tenants with the ability to refer a rent increase to a rent officer. This is to protect tenants from unreasonable rent increases that takes their rent to beyond the open market rate. Amendment 152 undermines the landlord's ability to contract with the tenant, as in practice a tenant could accept an initial rent when taking a tenancy and then immediately seek to have it reviewed. This could place a disproportionate burden on Rent Service Scotland and the Tribunal, and I believe the proper way to address issues of rent affordability is what this Government is already doing, building more houses. For Amendment 153, there would be little point in enabling sitting tenants in rent pressure zones to refer their rent to a rent officer, as the amount their rent could increase would be capped and therefore could not be assessed in terms of the open market rate. I would ask David Stewart not to press Amendments 152 and 153.
Okay, thank you, Minister. Can I invite David Stewart to wind up and indicate whether he wishes to press or withdraw his amendments?
Thank you, Convener. I wish to press both Amendments 152 and 153. I would stress particularly in 152 that the person who would be arbitrating on the rent increase is the rent officer, which government themselves have set up. We're not talking about some outside Rachman-like landlord who will be deciding on this. I think it's really important that there's a bit of proportionality here, and I believe under the European Convention on Human Rights, we need to look at providing protection to tenants. So both these amendments, I think, are fair, they're proportionate, and they are represented by all the organisations I stressed earlier who know what it's like to deal with tenants in the frontline services.
Okay, thank you. The question is that Amendment 152 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
No.
We are not agreed. In that case, I will call a division. Those in favour of Amendment 150, please show. No, we'll take them separately. Sorry, my apologies. those in favour of Amendment 152, please show. And those against Amendment 152, please show. Okay, there is... Amendment number 152, the result is yes, 2, no, 5, abstentions, 0. The amendment is therefore not agreed to. Okay, I call Amendment 153 in the name of David Stewart, already debated with Amendment 152. And can I ask David Stewart to move or not move?
Move.
Okay, in that case, the question is that Amendment 153 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? We are not agreed. I will therefore call a division. Those in favour of Amendment 153, please show. Those against Amendment 153, please show. Amendment number 153, the result is yes, 2, no, 5, There were no abstentions. The amendment is therefore not agreed to. I call Amendment 39 in the name of the Minister, already debated with Amendment 36. And can I invite the Minister to move formally?
Moved.
Thank you. The question is that Amendment 39 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The question is that Section 20 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
I call Amendment 40 in the name of the Minister, already debated with Amendment 30. And can I invite the Minister to formally move?
Moved.
Thank you. The question is that Amendment 40 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? We are agreed. I now call Amendment 41 in the name of the Minister, already debated with Amendment 30, and I invite the Minister to formally move.
Moved.
Thank you. The question is that Amendment 41 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The question is that Section 21 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
I call Amendment 42 in the name of the Minister, already debated with Amendment 21, and I invite the Minister to formally move.
Moved.
Thank you. The question is that Amendment 42 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? The question is that Section 22 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The question is that Section 23 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
I call Amendment 43 in the name of the Minister, already debated with Amendment 30, and I invite the Minister to formally move.
Moved.
Thank you. The question is that Amendment 43 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
I call Amendment 44 in the name of the Minister, already debated with Amendment 30, and I invite the Minister to formally move.
Moved.
Thank you. The question is that Amendment 44 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The question is that Section 24 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The question is that Section 25 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
I call Amendment 45 in the name of the Minister, already debated with Amendment 30, and I invite the Minister to move formally. Thank you. The question is that Amendment 45 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? I call Amendment 46 in the name of the Minister, already debated with Amendment 30, and I invite the Minister to formally move.
Move.
Thank you. The question is that Amendment 46 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
I call Amendments 47, 48, 49, 50, 51 and 52, all in the name of the Minister and all previously debated. Can I invite the Minister to move Amendments 47 to 52 on block?
Moved on block.
Thank you. I ask whether any member objects to a single question being put on Amendments 47 to 52. In that case, the question is that Amendments 47 to 52 are agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Thank you. We now move on to grounds for eviction, rent arrears. I call Amendment 53 in the name of the Minister, grouped with Amendments 54, 172, 173, 183, 184, 111, 111A, 111B, 185, 186 and 187. And can I point out that Amendment 183 preempts Amendment 184 and that Amendments 111 and 185 are direct alternatives. And I invite the Minister to move Amendment 53 and to speak to all amendments in the group.
Okay. Convener, I'll speak to my amendments 53, 54 and 111 and respond to Alex Johnson's amendments 172, 173, 184 and 187 and David Stewart's amendments 183, 185 and 186. Amendments 53 and 54 extend the amount of time available to a tenant to meet a liability arising as a result of a rent adjudication, where the final decision sets a higher rent than the amount the tenant is currently paying. It protects the tenant from the possibility of being evicted purely for failure to pay this sum due, unless, as with other rent arrears, the sum remains unpaid for three consecutive months or more. Where a tenant's rent is increased as a result of a rent adjudication, the tenant becomes liable to pay the landlord the extra amount he or she would have been due to pay if the rent increase had not been delayed by the adjudication. The bill provides the tenant with 28 days to do this. On the expiry of the 28-day grace period, any outstanding sum is currently treated as having fallen due on the date that the rent should have increased in line with the rent increase notice. If that was more than 3 months ago, this could allow the landlord to seek to evict the tenant on the rent arrears eviction ground. The effect of Amendment 53 is that if the tenant does not pay off this liability in full within the 28-day grace period, on the next day, the tenant will be treated as having been in rent arrears for 29 days only. This offers greater protection as a tenant cannot be evicted for rent arrears until he or she has been in arrears for at least 3 consecutive months. This will meet calls made by crisis during stage one to give tenants in this situation additional time to pay this sum before the landlord can seek to evict the tenant for rent arrears. Section 3 of the bill currently provides that the rent arrears ground is mandatory if on reaching the tribunal the tenant has been in rent arrears for a continuous 3-month period and at any point during that period the amount was at least one full month's rent. My amendment 111 provides that if on the first consideration by the tribunal the tenant pays off their rent arrears in full or reduces them below 1 month's rent, this will be a discretionary eviction ground. It's in response to the committee's recommendation in its stage one report that the Scottish Government give further consideration to lengthening the 3-month period allowed in the bill to pay off a 1 month rent arrears. The Scottish Government considers that the 3-month period is sufficient and strikes the right balance. Landlords need to be confident in letting out their property that they will receive rent and should not have to wait any longer before referring a case to the tribunal. But it's recognised that rent arrears can also be a problem for tenants who might be suffering financial hardship. That's why tenants will be provided with information on their rights and where to get money advice as part of the notice to leave. The effect is that the tenant is given further time to make repayments to the landlord prior to the tribunal first considering the case. Alec Johnson's amendments 172 and 173 would allow a landlord to apply to the tribunal for an eviction order on the basis of rent arrears without the tenant needing to be given 28 days notice, and I cannot support this. This could mean that a tenant had to defend an eviction application immediately after the tribunal had declined to grant an eviction order. Where the tribunal has endorsed the tenant's right to stay in the property in at least the short term, that should be respected. The notice period in relation to rent arrears is not a particularly long one, and it's only right that the landlord should not be able to make subsequent applications without first giving the tenant that notice. If what Mr. Johnson is concerned about is cases which are borderline, the tribunal would be able to address this by exercising its power to adjourn. It would be able to allow a short period to see if some or all of the arrears are paid off during that time and then make its decision accordingly. It does not need to decline to grant eviction orders solely on the basis of a mere promise to pay, which might never materialise. Amendments seek to remove the requirement for the tenant to have been in arrears for 3 consecutive months before he or she can be evicted for those arrears, and I cannot support these amendments as they would impose an unreasonably low threshold of tolerance. There is no time frame within which these 3 separate months need to fall, so the months in which arrears have occurred could be years apart and long since paid off. Even if there was a requirement for the 3 non-consecutive months to fall within a particular period, I could not support this amendment. The government's intention is that the eviction ground should apply only where there is a cumulative failure to pay all sums that the tenant is due to pay. I appreciate that Mr. Johnson may be concerned that 3 consecutive months of arrears could be a long time for a landlord to wait if he or she is not receiving any rent with which to pay the mortgage. However, that's why I've always been clear that a landlord could choose to serve a notice on a tenant after 1 month or 2 months. Of course, the eviction ground would not be satisfied at that point, but the landlord is only saying that if the eviction ground does apply at the end of the notice period, then the landlord can go to the tribunal without further delay. The notice will also have signposts of sources of advice which may help the tenant to pay off their arrears. However, if the arrears are paid off before the tenant has been in arrears for a 3-month period, the landlord would not be able to evict the tenant. I therefore ask Alex Johnson not to press his amendments. Amendments 183, 185 and 186 change the mandatory ground qualifying amount to 3 full months' rent. This means that if a tenant was in rent arrears of less than 3 full months' rent, the repossession ground would be discretionary. It also calculates whether the qualifying amount is met as of the date of the tribunal hearing, rather than it being at any point during the period of arrears. Rent arrears is an important issue for landlords and one that ultimately can make their business unviable. Landlords need to be confident that in letting out their property, they will receive the rent. Many landlords in the private rented sector are not large businesses who can weather cash flow problems. If we make letting unviable, it will drive down supply and disadvantage all tenants in the longer term. And it's therefore important to strike a balance here between the needs of those tenants who may fall into arrears and need time to make that up, and landlords who may have a mortgage to pay. I am already bringing forward an amendment 111, which provides that if in first consideration by the tribunal, the tenant has paid off their rent arrears in full or reduced them below 1 month's rent, the tribunal would not be obliged to grant an order for eviction. With my further amendment, I think what we have in the bill strikes the right balance on this ground, so I do not support this amendment. I therefore ask David Stewart not to progress his amendments, and I move my amendment 53.
Thank you, Minister. I now call on Alec Johnson to speak to Amendment 172 and other amendments in the group.
Thank you very much. The purpose of my amendments 172 and 173 is to ensure that the landlord is in a relatively strong position and is able to implement the law effectively on his behalf. That's why I think it's necessary that they will be able to go back to the tribunal for support where the legislation indicates that they ought to be able to. The other amendments I will speak to in a more general sense because they all have the same objective, and that is to deal with the concept of consecutive in three consecutive months. It is the case that there have been issues in the past which have given difficulties where rent arrears have built up over a period and cannot be described as consecutive but are still considerable. There is also the danger that we might return to a position we've seen before where landlords dealing with a situation of rent arrears may find that a small amount of these arrears are paid off in order to reduce the period and prevent the case from progressing. The policy memorandum for the bill states that the Scottish Government recognises that landlords must have confidence that they can remove a tenant swiftly in cases of non-payment of rent. This is a ground which will be used often, so it is absolutely critical from the point of view of both parties that it is clear and fair. I believe that my amendments in this section or in this grouping have the effect of giving clarity and fairness to the relationship between landlord and tenant in relation to rent arrears.
Thank you. I now invite David Stewart to speak to Amendment 183 and other amendments in the group.
Thank you, Convener. I note that the Scottish Government has brought forward Amendment 111 to the rent arrears ground in the bill, which has gone some way to alleviating the concerns of organisations such as Shelter Scotland, and I welcome the Scottish Government amendment. However, there is still a concern that a tenant could be evicted for as little as 1 month's rent arrears. I'm of a view that this is too low an amount of rent arrears to be evicted for, especially when the tenant is able to show that they're likely to be able to pay off the arrears in a reasonable time frame. The three amendments I've submitted have, I believe, simplified what was in the original draft, and it prevents tenants from the risk of eviction where they have a relatively low amount of rent arrears. I'm therefore proposing that where a tenant accrues 3 months' rent arrears, the landlord will be able to seek a mandatory order for eviction. And if the arrears are below the amount, the tribunal can consider what is reasonable in the circumstances to grant the order. This, of course, would include the circumstances of the landlord as well as the tenant.
Continue.
I'm finished.
Sorry, thank you.
Sorry, if you pay attention, you know that.
Thank you, Mr. Stewart. That's helpful, as always. I don't see any other members wishing to contribute at this stage, in which case I will invite the Minister to wind up.
Nothing further to add than I think we have got it proportionate with our amendments.
Okay, thank you, Minister. The question is that Amendment 53 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
I call Amendment 54 in the name of the Minister, already debated with Amendment 53, and I invite the Minister to formally move.
Moved.
The question is that Amendment 54 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
I call Amendment 55 in the name of the Minister, already debated with Amendment 30, and I invite the Minister to formally move.
Moved.
Thank you. The question is that Amendment 55 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yeah.
The question is that Section 26 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? I call Amendment 56 in the name of the Minister, already debated with Amendment 21, and I invite the Minister to formally move.
Moved.
Thank you. The question is that Amendment 56 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yep.
Okay, thank you. We now move on to grounds for eviction, property required for another purpose, and I'd like to welcome at this stage Patrick Harvey, who has joined us for our proceedings. I call Amendment 57 in the name of the Minister, grouped with Amendments 88, 89, 90, 91, 92, 93, 94, 177, 178, 95, 96, 97, 98, 99 and 179. And I invite the Minister to move Amendment 57 and to speak to all amendments in the group.
Okay. Convener, I will speak to my amendments 57, 88 to 89 and to Alex Johnson's amendments 177 and 179. Amendment 57 is a minor consequential amendment. Section 27 sets out how rent officers and the first tier tribunal are to determine the open market rent for a rented property. In doing so, it makes reference to the eviction grounds which currently require or include a pre-tenancy notice. Amendments 90 and 98 propose to remove those notices, meaning that the reference to them in Section 27 will no longer be appropriate. Amendments 88 and 89, 91, 94 and 95, the bill contains repossession grounds which enable a landlord to regain possession of a let property if he or she intends to sell it, live in it, refurbish it or change its use. Amendment 88 strengthens the landlord intends to sell repossession ground by ensuring that a landlord cannot give his property away or sell it for a nominal sum in order to evict a tenant. Instead, a landlord will only be able to apply to the tribunal for an eviction order where they are looking to sell their property in the open market. Where a repossession ground refers to a landlord's intention, a landlord must provide evidence to the first-tier tribunal of his or her intention, and the tribunal must be satisfied that the ground is met before granting recovery of possession to the landlord. I know that the robustness of the grounds was an issue raised during the Stage 1 debate, in particular those grounds which include an intention by the landlord, and some stakeholders are concerned that these grounds may be open to misuse. And that's why I've brought forward Amendments 89, 91, 94 and 95. Amendment 89 provides examples of the type of evidence that the first tier tribunal may consider when determining if the landlord genuinely wants to sell and includes a letter of engagement from an estate agent or a recently prepared document such as a home report. For refurbishing the property, Amendment 91 includes examples of evidence such as planning permission or a contract between the landlord and an architect. Where the landlord or family member intends to live in the property, Amendment 94 provides that an example of evidence that might be used is an affidavit stating that the person has that intention. And if changing the use of the property, Amendment 95 provides that an example of evidence that might be used is planning permission, which would be required. This responds to calls from stakeholders for examples of the types of evidence that may be required to demonstrate this ground on the face of the bill. Deciding on whether the ground is met is entirely up to the tribunal. It will be for the tribunal to consider whether the evidence presented to it during any repossession case is sufficient. I'll move to Amendment 90. Schedule 3 of the bill provides a mandatory ground for eviction where a property has been repossessed by the lender. The tribunal must order possession of a property if a mortgage lender intends to sell the let property and certain specified conditions are met. One of these conditions is that the tenant was given notice before the tenancy began that the tenancy might be ended on this ground. If the tenant is not made aware of this fact before the tenancy begins, the tribunal will have discretion on whether to evict the tenant. This amendment removed the requirement for the tenant to be given notice before the tenancy began, and therefore removes the discretionary stand of this repossession ground. In its evidence to the ICI committee, the Council of Mortgage Lenders outlined that lenders don't need to be notified when tenants change and new tenancies are entered into. Therefore, they've no involvement in the tenancy contract entered into between the landlord and the tenant, and have no way of ensuring a landlord issues a pre-notice to the tenant to advise them that this ground of eviction might be used. And I fully appreciate that lenders require certainty that they can obtain vacant possession in the event of mortgage default. Having reconsidered this ground, I agree that lenders must continue to have the confidence in their lending under the new tenancy. This amendment will achieve this by removing the discretionary element of this ground. Amendments 92 and 93. These amendments will mean that beneficiaries who have property held in trust for them can make use of the eviction ground that the landlord or family member intends to live in the property if the beneficiary wishes to use the property as his or her home. This eviction ground is provided for in Schedule 3 of the Bill. Amendments 92 and 93 provide that where property is held in trust, the reference to a landlord in this eviction ground is to be read as a reference to those with certain rights under the trust, essentially the trust beneficiaries. These amendments recognise that a trust beneficiary is the one with the true interest in the property, and so the idea of the landlord intending to occupy needs to be modified accordingly. This would enable the trustees to recover a let property for a person for whom that property is held in trust, where that person wishes to live in the property. Amendments 96 and 99, I move to. Schedule 3 of the Bill currently contains an eviction ground which enables a landlord to gain repossession of a property if it is required for use in connection with the purposes of a religion as a residence from which a religious worker's duties are performed. The ground in the Bill has a requirement to notify the tenant before the tenancy begins that this ground may be used to repossess. Amendments 96, 97 and 99 amend the ground by providing that the property must have been used for that purpose previously. The effect is that a landlord may only repossess a property on the ground that it is required to house a religious worker as a residence from which their duties are performed if it had previously been used for that purpose. During Stage 1, some stakeholders expressed concern that this ground continues to use the use of pre-tenancy notices which are currently used in the assured tenancy regime. Amendment 98 removed the requirement for the tenant to be given notice before the tenancy began that the tenancy might be ended on this ground. These amendments reaffirm my position that pre-tenancy notices are not required under the new tenancy and make this eviction ground narrower by ensuring that a landlord may only regain possession of a property under these circumstances if it had been previously used for that purposes. That purpose. Am I on to Amendment 177, Convener? The purpose of the Amendment 177 is to add an eviction ground where the landlord is a company who intends to let the property to a shareholder. The effect is to add another mandatory ground whereby a tenant may be evicted from his or her home. I have sought to strike a fair balance in setting the grounds for repossession in Schedule 3 of the Bill, and these include carefully considering rights of landlords to own and use their property and the rights of tenants to have a home. For example, where landlords want to recover possession to live there themselves or to house a family member, they have the right to recover the property. And I've also lodged amendments 92 and 93 to ensure that this eviction ground works where the property is held in trust so that the beneficiary may be housed. However, I don't consider it fair that a tenant can be evicted from his or her home where the landlord is purely a limited company and wants to let the property to a shareholder of that limited company. This ground may also be open to abuse, as there is no limit in the number of shares that a shareholder must have in order for this ground to apply. Amendment 178 inserts an eviction ground where the landlord is a trust and intends to let the property to a beneficiary of the trust. I understand why Mr. Johnson has put forward this amendment and thank him for doing so, but as you will just have heard, I've already brought forward an amendment, number 93, which deals with the situation where a property is held by a trustees. Rather than insert this as a separate eviction ground, I have proposed inserting this as a variation in the application of the existing eviction ground, which applies where a landlord or family member wishes to occupy the property. I would suggest that this is more appropriate, as this amendment is not really about adding a new eviction ground, but rather about modifying the application of the existing one to accommodate trust ownership. I would therefore urge Mr. Johnson not to press his amendment, but to support Amendment 93 instead. Amendment 179 would enable a landlord to evict a tenant so that the landlord can let the property to an employee or retired employee. And I have concerns about this amendment. It could result in a family being evicted from their home so that an employee or a retired employee of the landlord could move in. I think that it would be unfair to allow a family to be moved out in these circumstances. Indeed, such a result would be counter to the purpose of the bill to give people security of tenure in what is their home in the private sector. For that reason, I cannot support the amendment. I believe that we've got the balance of the grounds right and that we have now captured the reasonable circumstances that a landlord would need to recover possession of their property. And there's nothing in the bill that stops landlords retaining particular properties for tied housing for employees. I believe am I at the end of my amendments now? I'm quite lost here. So, accordingly, convener, I'm getting lost with the number of amendments here. I move Amendment 57 and ask Alex Johnson not to press his amendments.
Thank you, Minister. I now call on Alec Johnson to speak to Amendment 177 and other amendments in the group.
Thank you very much, Convener. The purpose of Amendments 177, 178 and 179 is to better reflect practice in some, particularly in rural areas, and the way businesses utilise housing. Often in marginal rural areas, housing is scarce and it is essential that housing is available for businesses that operate in these areas. Consequently, a number of different business models exist and will ensure that housing is available for those who work within their businesses. The three amendments deal with different circumstances surrounding that, but they do reflect actual practice in many areas. And to understand better why I have proposed these amendments, I almost have to stand the Minister's argument on its head. The need to have housing available is so vital to businesses that the alternative to getting involved in leases is to simply leave unused property empty. And in marginal rural areas where housing is already in short supply, the idea that businesses will leave houses empty rather than let them is something that we desperately need to avoid. Consequently, I believe it's necessary within this bill to have provisions which give the confidence to rural businesses that they can let property which is not currently being utilised and contribute towards the provision of local housing, knowing that should they require that property to house someone associated or formerly associated with their business at a later point, that they can regain possession. My concern is that if we do not provide adequately within the bill for that need, that rural property will lie empty rather than be let under the terms of the bill. That's why I'm motivated to propose these three amendments. Finally, there is one issue that I have with one of the Minister's amendments, and that is amendment number 88. I have had a number of correspondents who have commented on this relatively simple amendment that they believe the definition on the open market is too broad and may give them difficulties in the future. I would like to hear the Minister's comment on that.
I now invite the Minister to wind up.
Yeah, in response to Alec Johnson's comments, I'll deal with that first. In terms of the open market, we believe that is clear what the open market is. We don't think it is too broad, and you know, I'm not minded to change that. In terms of his amendment, his arguments in terms of retired employees or employees in rural business, we are working hard with the rural sector to look at how, the, you know, and they have to work at how they manage their stock. But in the same vein, housing in rural areas for families is at a shortage, and if a family is in a home and their children are at school there, I don't think it's fair that that is their home, and I don't think it's right that they should be moved out. So I don't accept his amendments.
Thank you. The question is that Amendment 57 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Question is that Section 27 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? Question is that Sections 28 and 29 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Thank you. We now move on to procedure for designating a rent pressure zone. And I call Amendment 154 in the name of Patrick Harvey, grouped with Amendments 155, 64, 65, 66, 67, 68, 69, 135 and 138. And I invite Patrick Harvey to move Amendment 154 and speak to all amendments in the group.
Thank you very much. Good morning, Convener. Very happy to have the opportunity to move Amendment 154 and speak to others. As a non-member of the committee, as a guest, I'll restrict my remarks to the amendments in my own name and leave members of the committee to consider the others. At present, the bill sets out the ability for local authorities to make an application to Scottish ministers, asking them to designate an area or part of an area as a rent pressure zone. Now, my instinct certainly is to welcome the move towards some ability for a measure to address rent prices when they've gone out of control. I think that's a problem in many parts of the country and needs to be addressed. It does seem to be initially slightly uncomfortable that local authorities can't simply be given the power to do so and need to be asked to make an application to Scottish ministers. But the section doesn't even place any particular requirements on Scottish ministers, as far as I can read it, in how they should handle an application. So my amendments 154 and 155 set out a time limit for Scottish ministers to give a response. I've suggested 3 months. I think that's a reasonable time limit for ministers to respond. And it also ensures that they must either designate the area, basically agree to the request of the local authority, or set out reasons why not. And it seems to me that the reasons why not must be related to the criteria under which the designation would otherwise have been made. So I hope that the Minister will be willing to agree that a reasonable period should be required, and that if the Scottish Government intends to overrule the stated intention and the priority of a local authority, that in their view a rent pressure zone should be declared, that the Scottish Ministers in those circumstances should set out clear reasons within that time limit. Otherwise, I fear that the lobbying power that would no doubt be brought to bear in the initial stages at local level would then simply have another crack of the whip, another opportunity to lobby at national level against necessary action being taken. And I move Amendment 154.
Thank you very much, Mr. Harvey. I now invite the Minister to speak to Amendment 64 and other amendments in the group.
I'll speak to Amendment 64, 6 to 69, 135 and 130, and to Patrick Harvey's amendments 154 and 155. Amendments 64 to 69, 135 and 138 I'll deal with first. My amendments will ensure the Scottish Government can act quickly to change or revoke a rent pressure zone in response to changing economic circumstances. They also broaden out the range of landlords and tenants' representatives with whom the government is to consult before designating a rent pressure zone from just those representing landlords and tenants within the proposed zone to those representing landlords and tenants within the whole local authority area that the proposed zone will be in. Regulations designating a rent pressure zone are subject to the affirmative parliamentary procedure. Amendments 64, 65 and 68 provide that the duties on ministers to consult landlords and tenants in the proposed rent pressure zone and provide supporting evidence to the Scottish Parliament, along with a summary of the consultation responses, are limited to making regulations to designate an area as a rent pressure zone. Amendments 135 and 138 provide that regulations amending or revoking a designation are subject to negative parliamentary procedure. This means that if ministers need to amend or revoke the designation at a later date, for example, because of increasing mortgage interest rates, they can do so using the negative parliamentary procedure, which is usually quicker than the affirmative procedure and doesn't prevent regulations from being made when the Parliament is in recess or dissolved. Section 33 of the Bill requires ministers to consult persons representing the interests of landlords and tenants within the area in the application before laying any regulations in the Scottish Parliament to designate an area as a rent pressure zone. Amendments 66, 67 and 69 expand the consultation duty in ministers when designating a rent pressure zone by providing that ministers must consult representatives of landlords and tenants within the whole local authority area within which the proposed zone would be located. Amendments 154 and 55 would give Scottish ministers 3 months from receiving a local authority application to either designate a zone or lay before the Parliament a document explaining why they've not done so by reference to the factors mentioned in Section 33(2)(a). Section 30 provides that Scottish ministers may, by regulations, designate a rent pressure zone and prescribe the cap for rent increase in that zone after receiving an application from a local authority. The level of any cap set would be at least CPI plus one. Section 63 requires the designation of a zone to be done by affirmative procedure. Section 33 provides that before laying a draft instrument before Parliament, Scottish ministers must consult on whether to designate a zone. When laying a draft instrument, Scottish ministers must also lay before Parliament a document that sets out the evidence that a rent pressure zone is required. I believe that rent pressure zones are a proportionate and balanced response to the issue of rents that have been rising too much in some parts of the private rented sector. This will provide Scottish ministers with the power to designate an area and to set a rent cap for sitting tenants. Where this needs to be done and an application has been made by a local authority setting out the case for this, then of course the Scottish Government will respond in good time. But I'm happy to commit to that in the face of the bill, as I do agree with the principle behind Mr Harvey's amendments 154 and 155 that there should be a time frame for Scottish ministers when designated a rent pressure zone or otherwise informing Parliament why they've not done so. However, it's important to ensure that any decision on whether to designate a zone is done properly, and I'd like to consider further how best to achieve this in the bill. It's also not possible for the bill to give assurances that a zone will be designated. Ministers can only bind themselves to lay regulations, and it will then be for Parliament to decide whether or not to approve those regulations. And I would ask Mr Harvey not to press his amendments for now, and I would commit to working with him to bring forward an acceptable amendment at stage three. And I would ask the committee to support my amendments.
Thank you, Minister. I now invite Patrick Harvey to wind up and indicate whether he wishes to press or withdraw his amendment.
Thank you, Convener. Well, it's a better response than I get to most of my amendments when I come to committees, I have to admit. I'm glad that the Minister agrees that there should be a requirement on the face of the bill for the Government to respond in a timely manner. I'm happy to have some discussions with the Minister about what a timely manner amounts to. I do think it's important that this... If an application is made this will be inevitably on the back of a significant period already of people arguing for it, making the case, having experienced a sustained period of rent increases. I think it's going to be very important that when we get to that point, action is taken quickly rather than dragging on for 6 months or a year or what have you. Where this problem exists to the point where an application has been made, then it clearly needs to be dealt with quickly. But given the Minister's comments about willingness to discuss how best to frame this, I am happy to seek leave to withdraw 154.
Thank you very much, Mr. Harvey. Okay. Are members agreed that Amendment 154 be withdrawn? We are agreed. I call Amendment 155 in the name of Patrick Harvey, already debated with Amendment 154. Patrick Harvey, to move or not move?
Not moved.
Thank you. In that case, we now move on to rent pressure zones, restrictions on rent increases. I call Amendment 58 in the name of the Minister, grouped with Amendments 59, 156, 60, 61, 62, 63, 157, 158, 70, 71 and 136. And can I point out that Amendment 59 preempts Amendment 156 and that Amendment 156 preempts 60 and 61. And can I invite the Minister to move Amendment 58 and speak to all amendments in the group?
Okay, Convener, I'll speak to my amendments 58 to 63, 70, 71 and 136, and Patrick Harvey's amendments 156 to 158. Amendments 58 to 63, 70, 71 and 136 set out in the face of the bill the process for assessing how much can be charged in respect of improvements that a landlord may have made to the let property, so that these can be recouped in a rent pressure zone. This is to ensure that landlords are not put off making improvements to properties in rent pressure zones. Section 30 of the bill provides that a local authority may make an application to Scottish ministers to designate a rent pressure zone. Rents would be capped in a zone for sitting tenants for up to 5 years. Any rent cap set by the minister for the zone would have to be at least CPI plus 1%. Amendments 58 to 63 amend the formula that must be used when calculating how much a tenant's rent can be increased within a rent pressure zone. The amended formula allows an amount for property improvement cost which would be determined by a rent officer. Amendments 70 and 71 set out how rent officers are to consider applications for improvements to a property. Any improvements paid for in whole or in part by the tenant will be disregarded, as will repairs, maintenance and decoration. Amendment 136 makes the regulations prescribing the application form subject to the negative procedure. Amendments 156 to 158 remove the formula to be used when calculating the rent cap for a rent pressure zone and replaces it with an ability to prescribe a set number of percentage points in the regulations to designate the zone. The Scottish Government has given careful consideration to how a rent cap may be set. Section 31 provides the formula for the minimum cap, which is CPI plus 1%, together with an additional percentage if appropriate, and a sum in relation to a landlord's improvements. It's important that to be clear on the face of the bill what the minimum rent cap may be, as this will enable landlords and investors to continue to manage their business effectively, including planning any future investment. This is what we consulted on, and this is what I consider to be the right approach to working with the sector on this. I cannot therefore support these amendments. Accordingly, I move my amendment 58 and would ask Patrick Harvey not to press his.
Thank you, Minister. I now invite Patrick Harvey to speak to amendment 156 and other amendments in the group.
Thank you, Convener. Not knowing that the Minister intended to move amendments in this area, I put in Amendment 156 and 157, which is consequential to it, simply in order to have some discussion of the issue. It did seem to me odd that a complex formula would be required in the legislation rather than simply giving the power for rent pressure zones to be created with a simple percentage number being included. I think given the comments that the Minister has made, I'd like to give that some further thought and consider again whether the issue needs to be addressed at all. One of the objectives that I think we ought to share is to ensure that tenants can make a clear and simple argument within a local authority area for action to be taken. And I think the simplicity would be attractive, but I'll give some further thought to the Minister's comments about those amendments. Amendment 158 within the same group addresses a slightly different aspect. Section 33 currently, if I can just come to that, says that one of the requirements in the document that must be set out showing evidence which leads ministers to believe that rents payable within the proposed zone are rising by too much. And it does seem to me that this will restrict the ability to use this new mechanism to address existing issues. Issues in parts of the country which are the precise reason why we're here having this debate. People have been arguing for action on rent levels for some significant time, and it does seem to me that if we pass legislation which requires ministers to set out evidence showing that rent levels are rising, then we'll be closing off the possibility to use this mechanism in places where we already have a problem of rents having risen. So Amendment 158 simply allows the option for ministers. It doesn't say that this has to be used, but it allows the option for ministers to set out evidence showing that rents are rising or have risen. And I would find it disappointing if the minister wasn't able to reconsider and accept Amendment 158.
Thank you very much, Mr. Harvey. And I now call David Stewart.
Thank you, Convener. The Minister will know that I've raised the issue of indexation before when we're debating this. And I notice on Amendment 59, the Minister lays out a formula for the cap on indexation. That is CPI plus one plus X. So let me give you an example. If Edinburgh was a rent pressure zone today, then the increase would be 1.3. And the reason for that is CPI is running at 0.3 plus 1, gives you 1.3, and any further increase would be any property improvement by landlords. Is that a correct analysis of the formula, Minister?
The CPI, I
was trying to help the Minister out rather than ask the Minister to explain the formula. No, but if the Minister insists, I will ask him to explain the formula. The formula currently is CPI plus 1 plus X.
Yep.
Okay, so CPI is the Consumer Price Index.
Yep.
The current rate of Consumer Price Index is 0.3 from January's figures. Mm-hmm. Plus 1 gives you 1.3. So that would be the cap, unless there was any property improvements by landlords. Is that a correct understanding of the formula?
Yeah.
Question the Minister. What? This is a debate, so I have to give other members the opportunity
Certainly.
To speak before the Minister winds up. So,
thank you, Convener.
So
the point I'm making to you, Convener, is my understanding of the formula is the Consumer Price Index, which we know the current figure of, plus one. So the current rate was 1.3. What I'm trying to verify is any additional costs would be property improvement by the landlord. If that is true, how are we going to verify that independently, what additional costs that would give? Because that would affect the cap on rents.
Right, thank you, David. Are there any other comments from members? In that case, I'll now invite the Minister to wind up.
The point that David Stewart made in terms of his assumption was correct, CPI plus, yes. In terms of the cost for property improvements, that would be determined by the Rent Assessment Committee. They would have to be absolutely clear that it was property improvements that took part, you know, within the time frame, and that it wasn't, they can demonstrate the cost of them. So the Rent Assessment Committee would determine that. In terms of Patrick Harvey's amendment, I've got concerns about it because it's not about recent rises, rent rises. He's talking about rises in the past. So I would have concerns about supporting that amendment as it stands.
Yeah. Thank you. The question is that Amendment 58 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? We are agreed. The question is that Section 30 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
I call Amendment 59 in the name of the Minister already debated with Amendment 58. And can I remind members that Amendment 59 preempts Amendment 156? Can I invite the Minister to formally move? Thank you. The question is that Amendment 59 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are. I call Amendment 60 in the name of the Minister already debated with Amendment 58. And I invite the Minister to formally move.
Moved.
The question is that Amendment 60 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
I call Amendment 61 in the name of the Minister, already debated with Amendment 58, and I invite the Minister to formally move.
Moved.
Thank you. The question is that Amendment 61 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
I call Amendment 62 in the name of the Minister, already debated with Amendment 58, and I invite the Minister to formally move.
Moved.
Thank you. The question is that Amendment 62 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? I call Amendment 63 in the name of the Minister, already debated with Amendment 58, and I invite the Minister to move formally.
Moved.
Thank you. The question is that Amendment 63 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
I call Amendment 157 in the name of Patrick Harvey, already debated with Amendment 58, and I invite Patrick Harvey to move or not move.
Not move.
Thank you. The question is that Section 31 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? The question is that Section 32 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
I now call Amendments 64, 65, 66, 67 and 68, all in the name of the Minister and all previously debated. Can I invite the Minister to move Amendments 64 to 68 en bloc?
Moved.
And I ask whether any member objects to a single question being put on Amendments 64 to 68. Nope, in that case, the question is that Amendments 64 to 68 are agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Thank you. I call Amendment 158 in the name of Patrick Harvey, already debated with Amendment 58, and I invite Patrick Harvey to move or not move.
The Minister, having stated she has concerns but not stated what they are, I would move that amendment.
Okay, the question is that Amendment 158 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
No.
We are not agreed, in which case I will now call a division. Those in favour of Amendment 158, please show. And those against Amendment 158, please show. Okay, Amendment number 158, the result is yes, 0, no, 7. There were no abstentions. The amendment is therefore not agreed to. I call Amendment 69 in the name of the Minister, already debated with Amendment 154, and I invite the Minister to formally move.
Moved.
Thank you. The question is that Amendment 69 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The question is that Section 33 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The question is that Section 34 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
I call Amendment 70 in the name of the Minister, already debated with Amendment 58, and I invite the Minister to formally move. Thank you. The question is that Amendment 70 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
I call Amendment 71 in the name of Margaret Burgess, already debated with Amendment 58, and I invite the Minister to move or not move.
Moved.
The question is that Amendment 71 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Okay. Next group is termination by agreement or by end of tenancy. And I call Amendment 159 in the name of Alec Johnson, grouped with Amendments 160, 169 and 176. And I invite Alec Johnson to move Amendment 159 and to speak to all amendments in the group.
Thank you very much, Convener. I move Amendment 159, the primary function of which is to facilitate the introduction of Amendment 160. Amendment 160 is, I believe, a relatively simple introduction of the concept that a tenancy can be ended by mutual agreement. It's important that if both parties are in an agreement, there are flexibilities for the tenancy to be ended. This is most likely to be initiated by the tenant, and for example, if they may want to leave a tenancy quickly, and if a landlord has a waiting list, they may be able to replace that tenant fairly quickly. I think this is a practical common sense amendment that allows for mutual agreement between parties. Amendment number 169 has the function of introducing the opportunity to propose amendment 176, which relates to the termination due to end of tenancy. I think it's sensible if a tenancy is agreed for a fixed period and is not renewed or further extended, that it should be possible to end a tenancy, and amendment 176 sets out the grounds on which that could be achieved. It also sets out a reasonable notice period for such a termination of tenancy to take place.
Thank you. No other members have indicated they wish to speak at this point, in which case I will invite the Minister to respond.
Okay, Convener, I respond to Alex Johnson's amendments 159, 160, 169 and 176. The overall aim of the private residential tenancy is to improve security of tenure for tenants, balanced with appropriate safeguards for landlords, lenders and investors. The Bill provides that the new tenancy is open-ended and can only be terminated by a tenant giving notice to the landlord or the landlord serving a notice to leave on the tenant on the basis of one of the eviction grounds in Schedule 3 of the Bill. Amendments 159 and 160 cannot be accepted as they insert provision which would allow the landlord and tenant to agree a termination date at the start of the tenancy. It is highly likely that landlords would have an unfair bargaining position in setting this date when granting the tenancy. This would wholly undermine one of the fundamental principles of the new tenancy. However, if the tenant wishes to leave during the tenancy, he can serve notice to that effect. It's then within the gift of the landlord to waive the tenant's notice requirement if he or she wishes to do so. So the parties can come to a mutual agreement, but it has to be instigated by the tenant, made freely and without coercion, and can only be done after the tenancy has started, so that the granting of the tenancy can no longer be used as a bargaining chip. Amendments 169 and 176 to enable the tribunal to grant an eviction order are consequential on the provisions which would allow the landlord and tenant to agree a termination date at the start of the tenancy. This is equivalent to the no-fault ground in the short assured tenancy regime, which we have deliberately excluded from the bill in order to create a more secure tenancy. I therefore can't support Alex Johnson's amendments.
Thank you. Can I invite Alex Johnson to wind up and indicate whether he wishes to press or withdraw his amendment?
I thank the Minister for her comments, and she is correct in her interpretation of the purpose of my amendments. Nevertheless, it is my view that these objectives are worthy of pursuit, and consequently I will be pressing Amendment 159.
Thank you, Mr. Johnson. The question is that Amendment 159 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are not agreed, in which case we will move to a division. Those in favour of Amendment 159, please show. Those against Amendment 159? Amendment 159, those in favour, yes, 1, no, 6. There were no abstentions. The amendment is therefore not agreed to. I call Amendment 160 in the name of Alec Johnson, already debated with Amendment 159, and I invite Alec Johnson to move or not move.
Not moved.
Okay. In that case, the question is that Section 35 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Agreed.
We are. I'm going to propose that we suspend this meeting of the committee for 10 minutes to allow members to have a short break, and we will resume in 11:25 or thereabouts. considerations of the private housing tenancies Scotland Bill at stage two. Now move on to sub-tenant protection, and I call Amendment 72 in the name of the Minister, grouped with Amendments 73, 74, 75, 76, 77, 78, 79 and 82. And I invite the Minister to move Amendment 72 and to speak to all amendments in the group.
Okay, I will speak to the Amendments 72 to 79 and 82. Section 36 makes provision to protect the security of tenure for those who have sub-tenancies. I don't envisage that sub-tenancies will be common in the private rented sector, but Section 36 is intended to ensure that where they are granted, the sub-tenants receive certain protections. Amendment 72 extends the meaning of lawfully granting sub-tenancy to also include a case where the sub-tenancy has been granted in breach of the head tenant's lease or that of someone further up a chain of sub-tenancies, but the sub-tenancy has been tolerated by the person who could have taken action as a result of the breach of agreement. In short, if the head landlord has allowed the sub-tenancy to carry on, he or she should not later be able to treat it as an unlawful sub-tenancy so as to deny the sub-tenant the protections the Bill provides. Amendments 73 to 79 and 82 are minor amendments so that the references to the eviction grounds in Section 37 match the names given to them in Schedule 3. I move Amendment 72.
Thank you, Minister. No members have indicated that they wish to speak. Do you have anything further to add? Fine. In that case, the question is that Amendment 72 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The question is that Section 36 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
I call Amendments 73, 74, 75, 76, 77, 78, 79 and 80, all in the name of the Minister and all previously debated. And I invite the Minister to move Amendments 73 to 80 en bloc.
Moved en bloc.
Thank you. I ask whether any member objects to a single question being put on Amendments 73 to 80.
No.
In that case, the question is that Amendments 73 to 80 are agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Thank you. Now move on to grounds for eviction, tenant status. I call Amendment 81 in the name of the Minister, grouped with Amendments 100, 101 and 103. And I invite the Minister to move Amendment 81 and speak to all amendments in the group.
Okay. I'll speak to Amendment Numbers 81, 100, 101 and 103, and these amendments make changes to the grounds for eviction which apply based upon the tenant's status. Amendments 81 and 103 I'll deal with first. Supported accommodation is offered in both the social and private sector. Where this support is provided by charities and other groups in the private rented sector, they often use short assured tenancies. The Richmond Fellowship raised the open-ended nature of the new tenancy with the Scottish Government as a concern. They currently use short assured tenancies, which enables them to recover possession if a tenant no longer requires the care on offer, so that this tenancy can be offered to someone else who does require the care. Supported accommodation providers play an important part in helping local authorities deliver community care, and I would not want to hamper their ability to do this. Therefore, Amendment 103 adds a new repossession ground which will enable the providers of supported accommodation to recover possession of a property where the tenancy was granted to meet an assessed need for community care and the tenant has since been assessed as no longer having that need under Section 12A of the Social Work Scotland Act 1968. Section 37 of the Bill provides that where the private residential tenancy of the person who was a subtenant's landlord is brought to an end by any of the grounds other than those that relate to a tenant's conduct, the subtenant's tenancy will also come to an end. Amendment 81 provides that this should also include the ground of supported accommodation. Amendments 100 and 101 I'll now deal with. Paragraph 7 of Schedule 3 to the Bill enables a landlord to regain possession of the let property where the tenancy was entered into to provide an employee of the landlord with a home as part of his or her employment, and the tenant is no longer a qualifying employee or did not become one. This is a mandatory repossession ground, which means if the ground is established, the tribunal must issue an order for eviction. Amendment 100 provides that if an application for eviction under this ground is submitted within 12 months of the tenant ceasing to be or not becoming an employee of the landlord, the repossession ground remains mandatory. Otherwise, the ground is discretionary. The effect of this amendment will be to ensure that the mandatory aspect is only available for a limited period of time and the landlord can't hold this over the tenant in perpetuity. Amendment 101 is a technical amendment which amends paragraph numbers. I move Amendment 81.
Minister, no members have indicated they wish to speak. Do you have anything further to add?
Nothing further, Convener.
In that case, the question is that Amendment 81 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
I call Amendment 82 in the name of the Minister, already debated with Amendment 72, and I invite the Minister to formally move.
Formally move.
Thank you. The question is that Amendment 82 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The question is that Section 37 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Thank you. We now move on to Notice of Termination, and I call Amendment 161 in the name of Alec Johnson, grouped with Amendments 162, 84, 163, 164, 165, 86, 166 and 167. And I invite Alec Johnson to move Amendment 161 and speak to all amendments in the group.
Thank you very much, Convener. I move Amendment 161. The purpose of my amendments in this group is to facilitate the regaining of a property by a landlord who has had a tenant leave their let property. It is the case that quite often tenants will have to leave at short notice, and consequently it is vital to ensure that properties are not left unattended and unlooked after in these circumstances. So the function of these amendments is to ensure that where a tenant chooses to leave a property, that the landlord can regain access, and in the case of Amendment 165, it requires that written notification be received by the landlord before they can act. I think it's something that would reassure landlords and also have the opportunity to bring properties back into use as quickly as possible after a tenant chooses to leave. So for that reason, I think these are practical amendments which can facilitate management of property and ensure that they do not sit empty unnecessarily or without care.
Thank you, Mr. Johnson. I now invite the Minister to speak to Amendment 84 and other amendments in the group.
Okay. I will speak first with my Amendment 84, Convener. A tenant will be able to end a tenancy by giving notice to the landlord. There is a concern that this flexible path to termination might be exploited by unscrupulous landlords to reintroduce the no-fault eviction ground by the back door. A landlord might insist that notice be given as a condition of getting a tenancy, so that 6 months after it begins, the tenancy ends without the landlord having to get an eviction order. To tackle this problem, Amendment 84 will allow tenants to dispute the validity of a notice they have given on the basis that he or she was coerced into giving it, or gave it when in the weak negotiating position of trying to secure a tenancy. I'll talk now to Amendment 86. If a landlord gives a tenant notice to leave, Section 40 dictates when the tenancy ends, but the parties might want it to end earlier. The Bill already allows for that, because under Section 38, the tenant can give notice to end the tenancy on a day of his or her choosing, and the landlord can accept that by waiving the notice period. Amendment 86 simply adds a flag to Section 40 so that nobody overlooks this route to ending the tenancy earlier than Section 40 would do. I'll now speak to Amendments 161 and 162. Section 38 of the Bill provides that a tenancy comes to an end on the day which is specified in the tenant's notice to his or her landlord. Amendments 161 and 162 provides that the tenancy could end on the day specified in the notice or on the day on which the tenant ceases to occupy the let property, whichever day is the later. The effect of these amendments is that if a tenant notified his or her landlord in writing that they were moving out on the 30th of January, but he or she remained in the property until the 14th of February, the tenancy would come to an end on the 14th of February. If we accept these amendments, we would end up with a very messy position in cases where the landlord has already granted a new tenancy to someone else on the basis of the current tenant having given notice. There would then be two people with competing rights to live in the property at the same time. The Bill's provisions are clear. Once the date of the notice given by the tenant passes, his or her tenancy is at an end. If he or she stays on, they could be ejected as having no right to occupy. The simple fact is that the tenancy is ended, so the tenant has no right to be there. I therefore ask members not to support these amendments. Amendment 163, the default notice period to be given by tenants to landlords when ending a private residential tenancy is currently set at 28 days when the tenancy has lasted for 6 months or less, and 56 days when the tenancy has lasted for 6 months or more. This amendment removes the second limb of this so that this period is 28 days in every case. The original intention was that tenants who had been in a property for longer would be required to give a longer notice period. Likewise, landlords are required to give tenants longer notice if the tenant has been in the tenancy for more than 6 months, except where the eviction is due to the tenant's conduct. However, I have listened carefully to all the evidence that was presented to the committee and note, for example, some tenants may need to end their tenancy within 4 weeks to take up a social tenancy. And in further consideration, I would not want to disadvantage tenants simply because they've been in their tenancy for more than 6 months. I'm therefore minded to endorse this change to the default minimum notice period to be given by tenants and would urge the committee to support that also. I'll now go to amendments 64 and 65. Section 40 of the bill provides that where the tenant has received a notice to leave from the landlord and moves out without requiring the landlord to obtain an eviction order, the tenancy comes to an end on the later of either the day the tenant ceases to occupy the property or the day specified in the notice to leave. Amendments 164 and 165 provide that a tenancy can come to an end on the day on which the tenant notifies the landlord in writing that he or she has ceased to occupy the property, or the day the tenant ceases to occupy the property, if that day is later than the date specified in the notice to leave. I don't think that that would assist parties, and I'm not entirely sure what Alec Johnson is trying to achieve. I think it overcomplicates what's a relatively simple process for consensual termination at the landlord's instigation. Therefore, I can't support these amendments. Amendments 166 and 167. Amendment 166 applies sections 22, 23 and 23A of the Rent Scotland Act 1984 to the private residential tenancy. These sections will apply as a matter of law, and nothing more needs to be done to achieve this. It's not limited to specific tenancy types. It's also not quite the case that the landlord would need to comply with a particular set of rules. It's rather there are provisions that which apply, and I would therefore suggest urge Mr. Stewart not to press amendment 166. But I do, however, recognise that it may be helpful to revisit the use of the term court proceedings in section 23 of the 1984 Act. I don't think that amendment 167 will necessarily addresses what we need to do in this regard, but I am welcome the point that Mr. Stewart has raised. I would ask him not to press this amendment on the understanding that we'll look into this and take steps to address this issue as a consequential modification if this is required. Accordingly, I ask the committee to support my amendments, and I ask Alex Johnson and David Stewart not to press their amendments, and I support Patrick Harvey's amendment.
Thank you, Minister. I now invite Patrick Harvey to speak to Amendment 163 and other amendments in the group.
Thank you very much, Convener. My hit rate's going up dramatically today. I'm grateful for the Minister's comments. I'll just very briefly set out the case in favour of this amendment, which has the support of Citizens Advice Scotland, who suggested it. I can understand why some people might instinctively feel that a landlord should be able to expect a longer notice period from long-term tenants, but the threshold of 6 months is by no means a long term tenancy. I was in the private rented sector for about a dozen years. I think every single place that I lived was for a longer period than 6 months. So in effect, the result of the bill as it stands would be that in every single instance of my trying to find a new place to live, I'd have had that longer two-month period in which I was locked in. And the consequences of this, the practical consequences of this, could leave people vulnerable either to having to pay 2 months' rent if they're having to acquire a new place to live before that two-month notice period has been served out, or potentially facing the risk of a period where they may not be able to guarantee getting a new flat before they've before that period has wound up. And so there could be a risk of at least in limbo homeless situation. There's also been a case made, particularly in relation to those having to leave an unsafe home with an abusive partner, that they may end up having to carry the extra bill that housing benefit would not in the circumstance where they're only able to claim for 4 weeks on the second property in order to move immediately. So for all of those reasons, I'm very pleased that the Minister has accepted this amendment, and I hope the committee will agree.
Thank you, Mr. Harvey. I now invite David Stewart to speak to Amendment 166 and other amendments in the group.
Thank you, Convener. As Patrick Harvey said, I'm also very positive for the comments from the Minister, and hopefully it's the start of a role for the later amendments we have later on. So my amendments 166 and 167 will ensure that it's crystal clear that the provisions of the Rent Scotland Act 1984, which make it a criminal offence to illegally evict a tenant, apply to the new private rented tenancy. I'm aware the Minister has made it clear that the provisions of the 1984 Act, which relate to illegal eviction, will apply to the new private residential tenancy without need to reference them in the face of the bill. However, I have concerns that the provisions of the bill which relate to consensual termination could leave some tenants in a vulnerable situation. Landlords may assert that tenants left the property and accepted the eviction notice when in fact they wish to remain in the property and challenge the eviction action. So therefore I'm moving these amendments to ensure that it's crystal clear that in the process of seeking an eviction, landlords must adhere to the provisions of the 1984 Act as they relate to illegal eviction. However, I have listened to the comments, Convener, from the Minister, and on the basis that the Minister will look at this again before Stage 3, I would seek permission from the committee not to move Amendment 166 and 167.
Okay, thank you very much. I now invite Alec Johnson to wind up and to indicate whether he wishes to press or withdraw his amendment.
Thank you very much, Convener. I have to say that Patrick Harvey's having a much better strike rate than I am today. But nevertheless, the Minister's comments and brief response to them, the Amendment 165 is, I think the Minister is often suspicious of my motives, but in this case I can assure her that my motivation for Amendment 165 is purely a practical one. It is, in my view, essential that property should not be left vulnerable, and where a tenant has confirmed that they have vacated a property, it's important that a landlord can access that property to undertake matters in relation to heating, for example, in winter months, or to take precautions against flooding, which are very contemporary at the moment. It is therefore my view that this is an issue that should be addressed in the bill. Regarding Amendment 161 and 162, I've listened carefully to what the Minister has had to say, and consequently I have decided that I will seek leave to withdraw Amendment 161.
Thank you very much, Mr. Johnson. In that case, are members content for Amendment 161 to be withdrawn?
Yes.
We are. In that case, we move on to Amendment 83. I call Amendment 83 in the name of the Minister, already debated with Amendment 21, and I invite the Minister to formally move.
Moved.
Thank you. The question is that Amendment 83 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
I call Amendment 162 in the name of Alec Johnson, already debated with Amendment 161, and invite Alec Johnson to move or not move.
Not moved.
Thank you. In that case, the question is that Section 38 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
I call Amendment 84 in the name of the Minister, already debated with Amendment 161, and invite the Minister to formally move.
Moved.
Thank you. The question is that Amendment 84 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Good.
Thank you. We now move on to initial period, and I call Amendment 85 in the name of the Minister, grouped with Amendments 87, 123, 128, 130 and 137. And I invite the Minister to move Amendment 85 and to speak to all amendments in the group.
I'll move 85 and speak to the other amendments in the group. The Bill currently provides for an initial period of a tenancy during which tenants are tied into the tenancy and landlords can only use limited grounds for repossession. The initial period was intended to provide landlords with certainty over the initial length of the tenancy and tenants with security that only limited grounds for repossession could be used by the landlord during the early stages of their tenancy. However, I've concluded that having an initial period is likely to cause problems for various groups of tenants, which I judge it best to avoid. First, I have noted the concerns raised by the committee about the impact that the initial tenancy could have in cases of domestic abuse. I've concluded that the initial period could make it difficult for someone in an abusive relationship to terminate a tenancy without incurring financial penalties. I don't think that we should create a position where someone suffering from domestic abuse should have to worry about the financial penalties that they might incur if they sought to escape the predicament. That's perhaps the most compelling of reasons for thinking again about retaining the idea of an initial period, but there are other reasons too. For example, a tenant having entered into a tenancy in good faith could find suddenly that they have to move quickly, perhaps to provide care and support to a family member living elsewhere, or to accept a new job, or indeed move elsewhere because it's part of their current job. These sorts of reasons have persuaded me that the initial tenancy could prove unreasonably restrictive and inflexible for tenants. The same is true for landlords. They might offer a tenancy in good faith and then find that they need the property urgently and unexpectedly to house a member of their family or are suddenly required to sell it. In light of these considerations, I have brought forward the amendments in this group to remove the initial period from the bill. The effect of the amendments will be to make the tenancy completely open-ended, with tenants able to give notice at any time and landlords able to use all grounds for repossession from the beginning of the tenancy. I believe this is a simpler and more straightforward approach that will benefit both tenant and landlord. I move Amendment 85.
Thank you, Minister. Alex.
Just briefly on the subject of the initial tenancy, I've had mixed views on consulting on this, but it has to be said that I believe on balance that many of the landlords who are letting property on a regular or a professional basis do see the initial period as being of some value. And as a consequence, at this stage, I will seek to oppose this amendment.
Thank you. Are there any other contributions from members? In that case, I invite the Minister to wind up.
Nothing further on that.
Thank you, Minister. The question is that Amendment 85 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Agreed.
We are not agreed. I will now call a division. Those in favour of Amendment 85, please show. Those against Amendment 85, please show. Amendment 85, the result of the division is yes, 6, no, 1. There were no abstentions. The amendment is therefore agreed to. I call Amendment 163 in the name of Patrick Harvey, already debated with Amendment 161, and invite Patrick Harvey to move or not move.
Moved.
The question is that Amendment 163 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are agreed. The question is that Section 39 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
I call Amendment 164 in the name of Alec Johnson, already debated with Amendment 161. And I invite Alec Johnson to move or not move.
Moved.
In that case, the question is that Amendment 164 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
No.
We are not agreed. We will then move to a division. Those in favour of Amendment 164, please show. Those against Amendment 164. Thank you. Amendment number 164. The result is yes, 1, no, 6. There were no abstentions. The amendment is therefore not agreed to. Okay, the question is that Amendment 165 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
No.
We are not moved. Thank you. I call Amendment 86 in the name of the Minister, already debated with Amendment 161, and I invite the Minister to formally move.
Moved.
Thank you. The question is that Amendment 86 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are. I call Amendment 166 in the name of David Stewart, already debated with Amendment 161, and I invite David Stewart to move or not move.
I'm on the basis of the not move, convener.
Thank you. The question is, I now call Amendment 167 in the name of David Stewart, already debated with Amendment 161, and I invite David Stewart to move or not move.
Move.
Thank you. The question is that Section 40 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Thank you. We now move on to first-tier tribunal, application of reasonableness test, and I call Amendment 168 in the name of David Stewart, grouped with Amendment 170, and I invite David Stewart to move Amendment 168 and speak to both amendments in the group.
Thank you, convener. In my view, this is probably the most significant of the amendments that I've put to date, and whilst the Scottish Government amendments will ensure more evidence needs to be produced by landlords are to be welcomed, I am still of the view that the legislation will not enable the tribunal to take all the factors relating to the case into consideration, including whether it is reasonable in the circumstances to grant the order. As we all know, convener, evicting a tenant from their home is a very serious sanction, which will affect not only the tenant, but potentially the family of the tenant and the children in that household. It is therefore vital to ensure that tenants and the landlord situations are fully examined by the tribunal before a decision is made either way. The tribunal should therefore be able to take all the circumstances into account fully and make an assessment as to whether it is reasonable in all the circumstances to grant an eviction order. So if a tenant has failed to pay rent over a number of months and the landlord is struggling to meet other financial commitments because of this, then of course the tribunal will be able to consider this when deciding whether to grant an eviction order. On the other hand, if a tenant has made efforts to pay rent and is continuing on a payment plan but technically fails the threshold for rent arrears before eviction, then the tribunal should be able to take this into account too. I cannot see any reason not to enable the tribunal to take the reasonableness into account when deciding whether to grant an eviction order. I'm sure the committee would not wish to see evictions granted in circumstances which are unreasonable. It would also address concerns raised by the committee or raised to the committee that by not enabling the first tribunal to take into account whether an eviction order is reasonable or not, the bill may not sufficiently take into account human rights considerations, principally Article 8 of the European Convention of Human Rights, which states, and I quote, that everyone has the right to respect for his private and family life, his home and his correspondence. I would be interested to hear the Minister's view on this amendment, which I'm hoping she'll be able to support, thereby ensuring there is a holistic, reasonable and balanced approach to deciding whether tenants should be evicted.
Thank you. No other members have indicated they wish to speak. I therefore invite the Minister to respond.
Okay, Convener, I'll say at the outset that I can't support these amendments. Amendment 168, which we've heard, would introduce a reasonable test for into every ground for eviction, and the effect of this would be for all mandatory grounds to become discretionary. The Scottish Government has given very careful consideration to the discretionary and mandatory balance in the grounds in Schedule 3. In my response to the Stage 1 report, I said that it was clearly important to get the grounds right so that tenants can be treated fairly and landlords can be confident in regaining possession of their property. With the lodging of my amendments 117 to 122, I believe that we've now struck the right balance, one that protects tenants but also provides landlords with confidence that they can manage their properties effectively and recover possession where necessary. The amendments I have put forward move a further 4 eviction grounds from mandatory to discretionary, which will allow the tribunal to consider all the circumstances of the case. And I would hope that would provide some reassurance to Mr. Stewart. But there remain some instances where we need to assure landlords that they will get their property back. Otherwise, we risk deterring them from remaining in the rental sector altogether. and any reduction in supply would only disadvantage tenants. Amendment 170 is a proposal to add directions to the tribunal to have regard to certain evidence in relation to the grounds for eviction where a landlord is to show intention and to have regard to certain factors when considering whether the tenant's behaviour is sufficient to warrant eviction. My amendments 88, 89, 91, 94 and 95 strengthen the grounds where a landlord is to show intent by providing in the face of the bill examples that the tribunal may consider when making a determination as to whether the ground is met. I do so in order to emphasise that the tribunal will need to be satisfied that a ground applies before an eviction order can be granted, and this will require evidence to be provided to it. I thank Mr Stewart for bringing forward the amendment, but I would urge him to accept my amendments instead, as I believe that the use of concrete examples will be helpful. As I say, I've put the amendments relating to the landlord's intention forward because I want people to be absolutely clear that the onus is on the landlord to prove that the ground is made out. But as far as the proposed inserted section 1A to 1D are concerned, I'm confident that the tribunal does not need to be directed what to consider. These are already things the tribunal can consider, and I believe it as a specialist forum can be trusted to have regard to all relevant facts and circumstances.
I now invite David Stewart to wind up and to indicate whether he wishes to press or withdraw his amendment.
Thank you, Convener. I think that, as I said at the start, these two amendments are very important. However, I hear what the Minister says. If the Minister would agree to meet me to discuss this further, I would then seek leave of the committee to withdraw both amendments.
I'm happy to discuss with Mr Stewart.
Are members content to withdraw that amendment? Thank you. Okay, I now call Amendment 169 in the name of Alec Johnson, already debated with Amendment 159. And I invite Alec Johnson to move or not move.
Moved.
Thank you. The question is that Amendment 169 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
No.
We are not agreed. We will therefore have a division. Those in favour of Amendment 169, please show. And those against Amendment 169, please show. Thank you. Amendment number 169. The result is yes, 1, no, 6. There were no abstentions. The amendment is therefore not agreed to. The question is that Amendment 169 be agreed to. We've done that. Yep. I call Amendment 170 in the name of David Stewart, already debated with Amendment 168, and I invite David Stewart to move or not move.
Yeah, not move, Convener.
Thank you. Question is, okay, we now move on to the first tier tribunal, general discretion of eviction, and I call Amendment 171 in the name of Alec Johnson in a group on its own, and I invite Alec Johnson to move and speak to Amendment 171.
I move Amendment 171 in my name, and I speak to it very briefly because it follows on largely from the previous debate which we had. It has, however, although it shares some words in common with Amendment 170, it is much shorter, and it seeks not to direct the tribunal as to what it should consider, but simply direct the tribunal, having considered the evidence, to make a clear and decisive decision. That's why it says it is reasonable in all circumstances to issue such an order. I hope this will simplify the process of the tribunal.
Thank you. Okay. In that case, there are no other members who wish to speak. Can I invite the Minister to respond?
Okay. Convener, Alec Johnson's Amendment 171 essentially has the effect of inserting an additional eviction ground into the bill, which covers any other reasonable circumstances under which the tribunal considers it reasonable to evict the tenant. We've consulted extensively on the eviction grounds, and I think we've got them right. The eviction grounds must be transparent. Tenants have a right to know the grounds under which they're to be evicted or they could be evicted. This amendment introduces a general catch-all eviction ground that could cover absolutely anything, and I don't think that this is right, and I can't support this amendment.
Thank you. I invite Alec Johnson to wind up and to indicate whether he wishes to press or withdraw his amendment?
Well, as I've said before in this debate, I think the Minister has understood my intention and that we have different policy intentions. I will therefore press the amendment.
Okay, thank you very much. The question is that Amendment 171 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
No.
We are not agreed. In that case, there will be a division. Those in favour of Amendment 171, please show. Those against Amendment 171, please show. In that case, amendment number 171, the result is yes, 1, no, 6. There were no abstentions. The amendment is therefore not agreed to. I call amendment 172 in the name of Alec Johnson, already debated with amendment 53, and I invite Alec Johnson to move or not move.
Moved.
Thank you. The question is that Amendment 172 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
No.
We're not agreed. There will be a division. Those in favour of Amendment 172, please show. Those against Amendment 172, please show. Amendment number 172, the result is yes, 1, no, 6. There were no abstentions. The amendment is therefore not agreed to. I call Amendment 87 in the name of the Minister, already debated with Amendment 85, and I invite the Minister to formally move.
Moved.
Thank you. The question is that Amendment 87 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yeah.
We are agreed. I call Amendment 173 in the name of Alec Johnson, already debated with Amendment 53, and I invite Alec Johnson to move or not move.
Not moved.
Thank you. We now move on to suspension of execution of order, and I call Amendment 174 in the name of David Stewart, grouped with Amendment 175, and I invite David Stewart to move Amendment 174 and speak to both amendments in the group.
Thank you, Convener. My Amendment 174 would make it clear that the First Tier Tribunal has the power to postpone an eviction order if they were of the view that granting the order and enabling immediate execution would cause undue hardship to the tenant. This could play an important role in providing tenants with enough time to seek alternative accommodation should the landlord seek an eviction under one of the mandatory grounds, and in my view is a key plank in preventing homelessness.
Thank you. No other members have... Sorry, I apologise. Mr Kelly?
Yeah, if I can just briefly speak in support of the motion, obviously... granting an eviction order is a serious matter and has obviously got serious consequences for the tenants. However, I think Mr Stewart sets out some reasonable mitigating factors, and I think his amendment adds some reasonableness to the bill, and I would therefore support.
Thank you. My apologies to Mr Ingram. I should have called him before inviting other members, but that's my fault. I now invite Adam Ingram to speak to Amendment 175 and the other amendment in the group.
Thanks very much, Convener. This amendment was suggested by Homeless Action Scotland, and its purpose is to ensure that tribunals can assist, delay or postpone action where it is in the best interests of all parties to do so. It's often the case in disputes between tenant and landlord that an agreement can be reached concerning arrangements to pay arrears or to modify behaviour. So in order to avoid unnecessary evictions, this new element, which replicates powers already available in relation to the assured and short assured tenancy regime, enables the affected tenant to demonstrate a pattern of amended behaviour over an agreed period, which should satisfy both tenant and landlord. Advice agencies report that this mechanism is used very frequently and successfully, and it would appear logical to replicate it in the new tenancy regime. The ability to delay or assist can benefit both tenants and landlords and fits with the tribunal ethos of seeking mutually acceptable solutions to problems where possible, rather than an overly legalistic and adversarial approach.
Thank you, Mr. Ingram. Do any other members wish to speak this stage? No. In that case, I will ask the Minister to respond.
Okay. I'll respond to Amendments 174 from David Stewart and Adam Ingram's Amendment 175. I mean, I thank the members for bringing forward these amendments and Mr. Stewart for bringing forward Amendment 174, but I'm not actually persuaded by the need for it. Firstly, the Tribunal will already have the power to adjourn under Tribunal rules if it sees fit to do so. It will not be obliged to dispose of an application immediately if there's a reason that more time would be appropriate. It also has the power to select an eviction date rather than this needing to be the date of the order. And it has a power under the Tribunal Scotland Act 2014 to review its own orders. What is appropriate will vary based on individual circumstances, and the Tribunal has the flexibility to deal with that. So if the tenant would face hardship, this could be taken into consideration and addressed as appropriate. Of course, questions about hardship may equally apply to landlords. We don't want landlords being forced into mortgage arrears, which might bring about the forced sale of the property. I'm therefore content that the Tribunal already has the necessary power to take into account potential hardship for both parties when deciding when an eviction order should take effect, which is the fair balance that the Bill is seeking to achieve. Amendment 175 seeks to give additional discretionary powers to the first-tier tribunal under the new tenancy. Specifically, it would allow the tribunal to adjourn proceedings in an application for an eviction order, cyst or suspend an order, and impose conditions on the tenant, for example, in relation to payment of rent arrears. If the conditions are complied with, the tribunal may recall the order. The tribunal is also given discretion to postpone the date in which an order for eviction takes effect. And I also thank Mr. Ingram for bringing this amendment forward, as it is an important point, and this is something that we've been looking at closely ourselves. I wholeheartedly endorse his desire to ensure that the tribunal has all the powers it will need. However, I would need to hear more about why this amendment is necessary and how it would operate in practice, as I'm not sure that anything more is required. The tribunal will have its own tribunal rules and it will be able to adjourn the proceedings without any bespoke provision needing to be made to that effect in this bill. The tribunal also already has the power to choose the date in which an eviction order will bring a tenancy to an end. Section 41(9) provides for this. A tenancy doesn't have to be ended on the date that the eviction order is granted. In terms of subsequent postponement, Section 43 of the Tribunal Scotland Act 2014 gives the Tribunal the powers to review its own decisions. These aspects of the policy are therefore already addressed, and they are addressed in the most appropriate forum, namely across all tribunal functions and not just for the purpose of the bill, of this bill. This leaves the questions of conditions being imposed. I'm wary of going down a route of allowing the tribunal to impose conditions in the way that the 1988 Act does. There are no reported Scottish cases on the effect of that provision. If a rent payment plan is put in place by the imposition of conditions, what would be the consequences of that? Would a tenant who fails to pay be held in contempt? There would seem to be a risk of adverse consequences here, and I'm not sure there's necessarily any benefit. However, I would like to reassure Mr. Ingram that there is nothing to stop the tribunal from adjourning a case to see if a tenant has paid the rent arrears and then making a decision of the adjourned hearing in light of what has happened in the intervening period. This would seem to be a cleaner and less problematic way of achieving the same result. I don't know that the imposition of conditions would add anything to this, unless it's intended there should be a consequence other than eviction. And eviction, of course, is already something the tribunal would have the power to order. If there's anything that Mr. Ingram considers can't be addressed through these existing mechanisms, I really would wish to sit and down with him and talk about it. However, even if it was felt appropriate to provide for the imposition of conditions, I have some technical difficulties with the amendment which would need to be addressed. So I'd be happy to work with Mr. Ingram on this point in advance of Stage 3, and indeed I would also welcome comments from stakeholders who've practical experience of having used the equivalent 1988 Act provision. But until we know that this does offer something more and does so in a way that we wish to replicate, I can't at this stage support including this provision in the bill. And I would ask Mr. Ingram not to press his amendment just now, and we can discuss further what additional powers, if any, are needed. Accordingly, I would ask both David Stewart and Adam Ingram not to press their amendments.
Thank you, Minister. I now invite David Stewart to wind up and to indicate whether or not he wishes to press or withdraw his amendment.
Thank you, Convener. I wish to press Amendment 174.
The question is that Amendment 174 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
In that case, there will be a division. Those in favour of Amendment 174, please show. Those against, please show. Amendment 174, the result is yes to no 5. There were no abstentions. The amendment is therefore not agreed to. The question is that Section 41 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Call Amendments 88, 89, 90, 91, 92, 93 and 94, all in the name of the Minister and all previously debated. And I invite the Minister to move Amendments 88 to 94 on block.
Moved on block.
Thank you. Can I ask whether any member objects to a single question being put on Amendments 88 to 94? The question is that Amendments 88 to 94 are agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Thank you. I call Amendment 177 in the name of Alec Johnston, already debated with Amendment 57. And I ask Alec Johnston to move or not move.
Moved.
Thank you. The question is that Amendment 177 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Mm-hmm.
We're not agreed, there will be a division. Those in favour of Amendment 177, please show. Those against. Amendment 177, the result is yes, 1, no, 6. There were no abstentions. The amendment is therefore not agreed to. I call Amendment 178 in the name of Alec Johnston, already debated with Amendment 57.
Moved.
And I invite Alec Johnston to move or not
moved.
Move. Thank you. The question is that Amendment 178 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
No.
We are not agreed. There will therefore be a division. Those in favour of Amendment 178, please show. Those against. Thank you. Amendment number 178. The result is yes, 1, no, 6. There were no abstentions. The amendment is therefore not agreed to. I call amendments 95, 96, 97, 98 and 99, all in the name of the Minister and all previously debated. I invite the Minister to move amendments 95 to 99 on block.
Moved on block.
Thank you. Can I ask whether any member objects to a single question being put on Amendments 95 to 99? In that case, the question is that Amendments 95 to 99 are agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Thank you. I call Amendment 179 in the name of Alec Johnston, already debated with Amendment 57, and I invite Alec Johnston to move or not move.
I'm going for the hat trick. Moved.
Thank you, Alec. The question is that Amendment 179 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? In that case, there will be a division. Those in favour of Amendment 179, please show. Those against Amendment 179, please show. Thank you. Amendment 179, the result is yes, 1, no, 6. There were no abstentions. The amendment is therefore not agreed to. I call amendments 100, 101, 102 and 103, all in the name of the Minister and all previously debated. I invite the Minister to move amendments 100 to 103 on block. Thank you. And can I ask whether any member objects to a single question being put on amendments 100 to 103? In that case, the question is that amendments 100 to 103 are agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are agreed. We now move on to grounds for eviction, tenants' conduct other than rent arrears. I call amendment 180 in the name of David Stewart, grouped with amendments 181, 182, 104, 106, 107, 108, 109 and 110. And may I point out that amendment 182 preempts amendments 104 and 105. And can I now invite David Stewart to move amendment 180 and to speak to all amendments in the group.
Thank you, Convener. I believe that my amendments 180, 181 and 182, which will amend the not occupying let property section of the bill, are required as they will clarify the process which must take place before a landlord can establish whether a property is abandoned. As the bill is currently drafted, I have concerns that the process a landowner must follow to prove that a tenant has left the property is too weak. This is not ideal, as it could lead to tenants who tend to remain in the property becoming homeless. My amendments are in line with the provisions of the Housing Scotland Act 2001, which lay out a set process for landlords to follow to regain possession of a property where it has been abandoned. It will ensure that tenants cannot be evicted unless it's clear they no longer intend to occupy the property. This is to ensure that should a tenant be away from the property for an extended period due to illness, work, holidays, etc., the landlord cannot evict them. If the ground is not changed, I feel that a tenant could return from extended absences and find they've been evicted. And again, I feel this is strongly in line with the European Convention of Human Rights, particularly the grounds of avoiding harassment of tenants.
Thank you. I now invite the Minister to speak to Amendment 104 and other amendments in the group.
Okay. I'll begin with Amendments 104 to 106. It's an eviction ground under the bill that the tenant is not occupying the let property as his or her only principal home, but it could be that a tenant is not living in the property because he has quite lawfully sublet it. If a landlord has not prohibited the tenant from subletting, he or she should not be able to evict the tenant for doing so. Amendments 104 to 106 therefore narrow the eviction grounds so that it cannot be used if the let property is being occupied as the only or principal home of a lawful subtenant rather than that of the tenant. If neither the tenant nor the subtenant are making a home in the let property, this eviction ground will still allow the landlord to bring the tenancy to an end. So landlords will have a way of tackling completely abandoned properties. They will also be able to use this ground if someone is occupying the property but that person doesn't have a lawful subtenancy. Amendments 107 to 110, the bill provides for a repossession ground which enables a landlord to gain repossession of a property where a tenant has failed to comply with the terms of a tenancy agreement. During stage one, some stakeholders, including Shelter, expressed concern that the tribunal should not have to grant repossession for breaching a statutory term of the tenancy and should be able to consider the circumstances in each case. Amendment 107 removes the mandatory element of the eviction ground so that a breach of any term of a tenancy agreement will give rise to a discretionary ground for eviction. Amendments 108 to 110 are a consequence of this change. I think this is proportionate and balances the rights of landlords and tenants, ensuring that the tribunal will only evict a tenant where it considers that a reasonable decision given the breach. Amendment 180, in the name of David Stewart, amends the not occupying the let property ground to change the reference from the tenant's home to the tenant's only or principal home. This amendment is not necessary. Every eviction ground in Schedule 3 begins with a sentence giving it a name or label. It is no more than that. As Section 41(7) of the bill makes clear, amending the name as Amendment 180 would do makes no difference in law to the circumstances in which the eviction ground does or doesn't apply. It would simply make the label longer. And I'm grateful for the opportunity. I'm now going on. The tribunal will need to be convinced that the tenant is not occupying a property as his or her only principal home. The law is already generous in how it interprets occupation of this type. A long holiday or even a stay in prison would not be a failure to occupy as an only or principal home. But I'm grateful for bringing this to my attention, Mr. Stewart, and I hope that I have reassured him somewhat with that. Amendment 181 sets out a requirement for a particular form of notice to be served on the tenant. However, the bill already contains a power to prescribe the form of notices, and the government will use that power to ensure that every notice sets out clearly what grounds for eviction might apply, what the tenant needs to do, and what the timescales are. As a result, the details specified in what would be paragraph 1A is not needed. Not only that, this form of notice appears to be misleading It states that if at the end of the notice period it appears to the landlord that the tenant does not intend to occupy the property, the tenancy will be terminated with immediate effect. But it then goes on to provide for the tribunal to terminate the tenancy. The tribunal would not be in a position to consider the eviction case if the tenancy has already been terminated. In addition, Amendment 181 requires the landlord to make inquiries. However, a landlord who had not made inquiries would have no reason to have sent an eviction notice on the basis of this ground. Finally, the amendment allows the eviction ground to be met only if the landlord would suffer harm as a result of the tenant's failure to occupy the property as the tenant's only or principal home. However, the private residential tenancy regime is designed to protect people's homes. It's not designed to protect houses, which have ended up being used only occasionally. Indeed, holiday lets are specifically exempted under Schedule 1 of the Bill. The existing assured tenancy regime under the 1988 Act applies only if and for so long as a property is used as a tenant's only or principal home. Our system similarly focuses on protecting people's homes. Where this eviction grounds applies, we're not talking about someone's home. Of course, a landlord may be perfectly happy for the tenant to stay on, but that would be for the parties to agree between themselves. For these reasons, I would urge members not to support Amendments 181 and 182.
Thank you, Minister. I call Alec Johnson.
Briefly, Convener, the Minister's amendments in this group are largely fine-tuning and reasonable, but the one that stands out is Amendment 107, which seeks to remove the provision that a first-tier tribunal must find that the ground named by subparagraph 1 applies if the tenant has materially failed to comply with a statutory term of the tenancy. I would have thought if a tenant fails to comply with a statutory term of the tenancy, that that would be a reasonable ground for the tribunal to find in favour of the landlord. I therefore can't see why this section is being, or this lines are being removed, and therefore will oppose the removal from the bill.
On to that point.
No, other than to say we don't know what the statutory terms of the tenancy, which will be done in regulations, will be laid out, but we think this is fair and proportionate to allow the tribunal to make that to have that power to be able to do that, and we think that's fairer than what Alec Johnson is suggesting and what we originally proposed.
Okay, thank you. Can I now invite David Stewart to wind up and indicate whether or not he wishes to press or withdraw his amendment?
Thank you, Convener. I've heard what the Minister has to say, and the Minister has previously agreed to meet me on the reasonableness ground. If she would also agree to meet me on Amendments 180 to 182, I would seek leave to withdraw all three of these amendments.
I'm happy to meet with the Member.
Thank you. Are members content to withdraw these amendments? Thank you. We move on. Okay. I call Amendment 181 in the name of David Stewart, already debated with Amendment 180, and I invite David Stewart to move or not move.
Not move.
Thank you. I call Amendment 182 in the name of David Stewart, already debated with Amendment 180. I remind members that Amendment 182 preempts Amendments 104 and 105, and I invite David Stewart to move or not move.
Not move.
Thank you. I call Amendment 104 in the name of the Minister, already debated with Amendment 180, and I invite the Minister to formally move. Thank you. The question is that Amendment 104 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? I call Amendment 105 in the name of Margaret Burgess, already debated with Amendment 180, and I invite the Minister to move or not move.
Moved.
The question is that Amendment 105 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? Thank you. I call Amendments 106, 107, 108, 109 and 110, all in the name of the Minister and all previously debated. I invite the Minister to move Amendments 106 to 110 on block.
Moved on block.
And can I ask whether any member objects to a single question being put? In that case, we put the question on each amendment individually. Okay, so I call... Okay, the question is that Amendment 106 be agreed to. Are we agreed?
Yes.
We are agreed?
Yeah.
Question is that Amendment 107 be agreed to. Are we agreed? In that case, there will be a division. Those in favour of Amendment 107, please show. Those opposed to Amendment 107, please show. Amendment 107, the result is yes, 6, no, 1. There were no abstentions. The amendment is therefore agreed to. Question is that Amendment 108 be agreed to. Are we agreed?
Yes.
We are agreed. The question is that Amendment 109 be agreed to. Are we agreed?
Yes.
We are agreed. The question is that Amendment 110 be agreed to. Are we agreed?
Yes.
We are agreed. Okay. I call Amendment 183 in the name of David Stewart, already debated with Amendment 53, and I remind members that Amendment 183 preempts Amendment 184, and I invite David Stewart to move or not move.
Move.
Thank you. The question is that Amendment 183 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
No.
We are not agreed. There will be a division. Those in favour of Amendment 183, please show. Those not in favour, please show. Amendment 183, the result is yes, 2, no, 5. There were no abstentions. The amendment is therefore not agreed to. I call Amendment 184 in the name of Alec Johnson, already debated with Amendment 53. And I invite Alec Johnson to move or not move.
Moved.
Thank you. The question is that Amendment 184 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
No.
We are not agreed. There will therefore be a division. Those in favour of Amendment 184, please show. Those not in favour, please show. The result of Amendment 184 is yes, 1, no, 6. There were no abstentions. The amendment is therefore not agreed to. Okay, I call Amendment 101 in the name of the Minister, already debated with Amendment 53, and I invite the Minister to formally move. Thank you. I call Amendment 101A in the name of Alec Johnson, already debated with Amendment 53, and I invite Alec Johnson to move or not move.
Not moved.
Sorry, my apologies.
Is that 111 rather than 101?
111, my apologies. 111A in the name of Alec Johnson. Not moved. So I call Amendment 111B in the name of Alec Johnson, already debated with Amendment 53, and I invite Alec Johnson to move or not move.
Not moved.
Thank you. I ask the Minister if she wishes to press or withdraw Amendment 111.
Moved.
Thank you. The question is that Amendment 111 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
No, that we are not agreed. There will therefore be a division. Those in favour of Amendment 111, please show. Those against, please show. The result of Amendment 111 is yes, 6, no, 1. There were no abstentions. The amendment is therefore agreed to. I call Amendment 185 in the name of David Stewart, already debated with Amendment 53. And can I invite David Stewart to move or not move?
Move.
Thank you. The question is that Amendment 185 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
No.
We are not agreed. There will therefore be a division. Those in favour of Amendment 185, please show. Those against Amendment 185, please show. The result of Amendment 185 is yes, 2, no, 5. There were no abstentions. The amendment is therefore not agreed to. I call Amendment 186 in the name of David Stewart, already debated with Amendment 53, and I invite David Stewart to move or not move.
Moved.
Thank you. The question is that Amendment 186 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are agreed. We're not agreed. In that case, there will be a division. The question is that all those in favour of Amendment 186, please show. Those against Amendment 186, please show. The result of Amendment 186 is yes, 2, no, 5. There were no abstentions. The amendment is therefore not agreed to. I call Amendment 187 in the name of Alec Johnson, already debated with Amendment 53, and I invite Alec Johnson to move or not move.
Not moved.
Thank you. We now move on to grounds for eviction, criminal and antisocial behaviour, and I call Amendment 112 in the name of the Minister, grouped with Amendments 113, 114, 115, 116 and 124, and I invite the Minister to move Amendment 112 and speak to all amendments in the group.
I'll start with Amendment 112, Convener. Schedule 3 of the Bill provides for the grounds under which a landlord can gain repossession of the let property. One of the grounds is where, after the tenancy has begun, the tenant is convicted of an offence connected to the immoral or illegal use of the let property or an imprisonable offence committed in the vicinity of the let property. This is presently framed in the Bill as a mandatory repossession ground, which means if the ground is established, the tribunal must grant an eviction order. Amendment 112 provides that if an application for eviction under this ground is submitted more than 12 months from the date of the tenant's conviction, the repossession ground is discretionary. The effect of this is that after a year has elapsed since the relevant conviction, the tribunal must consider whether the landlord has a reasonable excuse for not bringing the eviction case forward sooner. This change will ensure that a landlord cannot hold the mandatory repossession ground over the tenant's head indefinitely to be used at a later date. Amendments 113 to 115. Antisocial behaviour that causes alarm, distress, nuisance or annoyance is simply unacceptable. The current ground for antisocial behaviour covers the tenant acting in an antisocial manner towards people who live in the let property and antisocial behaviour committed within or in the locality of the property. On reflection, the government has concluded that this repossession ground doesn't go far enough, which is why I've brought forward amendments 113 and 115, which define relevant antisocial behaviour to encompass any antisocial behaviour for which it would be reasonable for the tribunal to issue an eviction order, given its nature, to whom it's related, and where it occurred. Antisocial behaviour is subjective in its nature, and evicting a person from their home is a serious penalty. So this amendment also introduces a test of reasonableness that the tribunal must consider before issuing any eviction order. Also, an application for eviction on that ground must be made within 12 months of it occurring, unless the landlord has a reasonable excuse. Amendment 114 makes a minor change to the language used in this ground to ensure consistency. It changes the word acting in an antisocial manner to the word behaving in an antisocial manner. Antisocial behaviour will not be tolerated, and we need to ensure that where serious antisocial behaviour occurs, a landlord can take the ultimate action to evict the tenant. The tribunal will consider all of the evidence presented to it, including where the behaviour took place, before deciding whether it is reasonable to do so. Amendment 116 provides a landlord with a further course of redress when there is another person living in or frequenting the property who has acted in a criminal or antisocial manner. The antisocial behaviour and criminal conviction grounds in the Bill as introduced relate solely to the behaviour of the tenant. This amendment introduces another ground which will enable a landlord to regain possession where a tenant associates in the let property with a person who has a relevant conviction or engaged in relevant antisocial behaviour. A relevant conviction is where, after the tenancy has begun, this person is convicted of using or allowing the use of the let property for an immoral or illegal purpose, or has been convicted of an offence committed in or in the locality of the let property, which is punishable by imprisonment. Relevant antisocial behaviour is any behaviour which, if it had been engaged in by the tenant, might result in the tenant being evicted. This is a discretionary repossession ground, so the tribunal must also be satisfied that it's reasonable to evict the tenant. If the tribunal is considering the case more than 12 months after the relevant conviction or incident of antisocial behaviour, it must also consider whether there's a reasonable excuse for the landlord's delay in making an application to it. In a case involving joint tenants, the ground applies to any one of them. Amendment 124 is a technical amendment to join up Amendment 116 with the ability of a landlord to provide the shorter notice period of 28 days when seeking an eviction order on the basis of certain grounds. This will ensure that a landlord can move swiftly in order to address this antisocial behaviour. I move Amendment 112.
Thank you, Minister. No members have indicated they wish to speak. Do you have anything further to add?
Nothing further.
In that case, the question is that Amendment 112 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are agreed. I call Amendments 113, 114, 115 and 116, all in the name of the Minister and all previously debated. I invite the Minister to move Amendments 113 to 116 on block.
Moved on block.
Thank you. Can I ask whether any member objects to a single question being put on Amendments 113 to 116? In that case, the question is that Amendments 113 to 116 are agreed to. Are we all agreed? Thank you. We now move to grounds for eviction, legal impediment to let continuing. And I call Amendment 188 in the name of Patrick Harvey, grouped with Amendments 117, 118, 119, 120, 121 and 122. Can I point out that Amendment 188 preempts Amendment 117? And can I invite Patrick Harvey to move Amendment 188 and speak to all amendments in the group?
Thank you, Convener. Once again, I'll limit my remarks to the amendment in my own name and leave members of the committee to discuss the others. In Part 4 of the Bill, Section 14 sets out that a ground for eviction is that the landlord is not registered by the relevant local authority under the Landlord Registration Scheme. And effectively, the two triggers which would bring this ground into effect are that the local authority has either refused to enter the landlord in the register or has removed them from it. Those triggers would only apply in relation to something that the landlord has done, not to something that the tenant has done. And it does seem to me basically unjust that a tenant would be subject to eviction when they have done nothing wrong, that they would lose their home on the basis of the landlord's behaviour which has led to them being removed from the register. Let's remember that that fit and proper person test in the landlord registration scheme is not a high bar. It's not a high bar by any means. And so for a landlord to be in a situation as serious as it would take to have them removed from the register, I think is clearly something which should not impact on the tenant in this way, leading to an eviction. It seems to be far more appropriate in those circumstances that a management order would be made available to ensure that the tenancy can be managed by a social landlord or another responsible entity or body who's able to ensure that the tenant can continue in that property. Now, I acknowledge that Amendment 188 wouldn't achieve that. I've lodged it in order that we can have the debate on that point of principle, and I hope that the Minister will engage directly in the question of what is the proper response when a landlord has behaved so badly that they're kicked off the register. Is it really the proper response that the tenant should suffer eviction? And as well as that question of justice, I would also raise the possibility of a practical consequence of this. If, for example, a local authority responded to a serious criminal offence by a landlord with a significant number of properties in a community, they would be faced with the prospect either of removing them from the register and leaving a large number of tenants facing almost immediate eviction, or delaying taking action and allowing that landlord to continue to let to new tenants. I do think there's a serious consequence of this. If we don't have an alternative approach, I've no doubt at all that the Scottish Government's many very excellent lawyers would be able to craft a better way of producing an alternative approach to this kind of situation. But it does seem to me that the bill as it stands is wrong, and I hope that the Minister will agree that an alternative might be sought. On that basis, I would like to move Amendment 188.
Okay, thank you very much, Mr. Harvey. Okay. Can I invite the Minister to speak to Amendment 117 and other amendments in the group?
Okay, thank you, Convener. I'll speak firstly to Amendments 117 to 122. When considering the eviction grounds, we want to ensure that they strike an appropriate balance between the rights of tenants to the right to respect for their home and the rights of private landlords. The legal impediment to the let continuing repossession grounds in the Bill are refusal or revocation of the landlord's registration by the local authority. Revocation of their HMO licence or an overcrowding statutory notice has been served on the landlord. These grounds are mandatory, which means if the tribunal establishes that the grounds exist, it must issue an eviction order. Having considered the evidence presented to the committee, I think it would be disproportionate to mandatorily evict a tenant from his or her home simply because their landlord has in some way failed to comply with duties and legislation. For example, it might not be fair if a tenant was evicted just because the landlord registration was revoked by the local authority. The tribunal should have the power to consider all of the evidence presented to it in such cases and make a decision based on whether it would be reasonable to issue an eviction order. So I've brought forward amendments 117 to 122 to change the nature of the legal impediment to let continuing grounds from mandatory to discretionary. This means that even where the tribunal establishes that the necessary facts to make out the eviction ground exist, the tribunal will still have a discretion about whether or not to evict the tenant, and it will only do so if it's considered reasonable. Amendment 188, Patrick Harvey's amendments, it said it's an offence for a landlord to operate without being registered with the local authority. And under the current assured tenancy system, most landlords use short assured tenancy agreements, which can be terminated on a particular date. So if a landlord ceases to be registered with the local authority, he or she should terminate the short assured tenancy to avoid committing the offence of letting property when unregistered. Given the open-ended nature of the new private residential tenancy, the landlord requires some way of bringing a tenancy to an end where she or he has been refused registration or had it revoked. This eviction ground in the Bill therefore provides the means by which the landlord can bring a tenancy to an end. To exclude this would undermine the system of landlord registration and could lead to a landlord being found guilty of an offence for continuing to let the property. And therefore, accordingly, I ask the committee to support my amendments, and I would ask Patrick Harvey not to press his.
Okay, no other members have indicated that they wish to speak. Can I invite Patrick Harvey to wind up and to indicate whether he wishes to press or withdraw his amendment?
Thank you. I acknowledge that the Minister's amendments in this group are an improvement to the Bill as it stands. I do feel that we are in danger of imagining that there's a binary choice here, that either we have to allow a landlord to continue to be registered and therefore potentially, even after having being guilty of some kind of infringement, being able to continue to let new tenants, or we have to remove them from the register and lead to the potential for eviction in order to protect them from committing a subsequent criminal offence. I'm still not convinced that the option of a compulsory management order isn't the right way to go. And I would encourage the Minister to give some further thought to that before stage three and to consider whether, in these circumstances, allowing that tenancy to continue to operate but be managed by another body, one which is a fit and proper person, whether that's the appropriate response to this kind of situation. Having said that, and with the possibility of perhaps communicating with the Minister ahead of stage three, I would ask to withdraw 188.
Thank you. Minister, do you want to indicate whether you'd be willing to meet with Mr. Harvey?
I'm happy to meet with Mr. Harvey and other members of the committee.
And are members content to withdraw that amendment? Okay, thank you. I call Amendment 117 in the name of the Minister, already debated with Amendment 188, and I invite the Minister to formally move.
Moved.
Thank you. The question is that Amendment 117 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are. I call Amendment 118 in the name of the Minister, already debated with Amendment 188, and I invite the Minister to formally move.
Moved.
Thank you. The question is that Amendment 118 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? We are agreed. I call Amendment 119 in the name of the Minister, already debated with Amendment 188, and I invite the Minister to formally move.
Moved.
Thank you. The question is that Amendment 119 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
I call Amendment 120 in the name of the Minister, already debated with Amendment 188, and I invite the Minister to formally move.
Moved.
Thank you. The question is that Amendment 120 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
I call Amendment 121 in the name of the Minister, already debated with Amendment 188, and I invite the Minister to formally move.
Move.
The question is that Amendment 121 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are agreed. I call Amendment 122 in the name of the Minister, already debated with Amendment 188, and I invite the Minister to formally move.
Moved.
The question is that Amendment 122 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The question is that Schedule 3 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
I call Amendment 175 in the name of Adam Ingram, already debated with Amendment 174, and I invite Adam Ingram to move or not move.
None.
Thank you. I call Amendment 176 in the name of Alec Johnston, already debated with Amendment 159, and I invite Alec Johnston to move or not move.
Not moved.
Thank you. The question is that Section 42 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? We are. I call Amendment 123 in the name of the Minister, already debated with Amendment 85, and I invite the Minister to formally move.
Move.
Thank you. The question is that Amendment 123 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? Okay. I call Amendment 124 in the name of the Minister, already debated with Amendment 112, and I invite the Minister to formally move. The question is that Amendment 124 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? The question is that Section 44 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The question is that Sections 45 and 46 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are agreed. We now move on to wrongful termination. I call Amendment 189 in the name of Patrick Harvey, grouped with Amendments 125, 190, 191, 126, 192, 127 and 193, and I invite Patrick Harvey to move Amendment 189 and to speak to all amendments in the group.
Thank you, Convener. My last go with you today in this group. Sections 47 and 48 deal with wrongful termination, and it's very welcome that there is a provision to address a situation in which either a tribunal has issued an eviction order after having been misled, or where a tenant has been persuaded to give up a property after having been misled. I think I can't be the only MSP who's had constituents raising situations not unlike this, where you know, misleading information or attempts to mislead have been used to persuade a tenant to leave or to require a tenant to leave a property that they otherwise are happy to continue to rent. So it's really important that there's a provision for dealing with this kind of situation. However, on both of these sections, the action which can be taken requires to be initiated by the former tenant themselves. And I don't think it's difficult to understand that a tenant who's lost their home in this way has got a great deal of other stuff to be getting on with in finding a new place to live, settling into it. Very few situations, I think, would see a tenant having either the information that they would need or being in a kind of situation which would make it easy for them to challenge their former tenant in this way and to have appropriate action taken. So my amendments address both of these sections by allowing a person providing independent advocacy services on the tenant or joint tenant's behalf to initiate this kind of action. I've suggested that this might include a housing charity, a welfare rights advisor. I'm sure we can imagine a range of different organisations being able to take that action on a tenant's behalf. And Amendment 191 is consequential to both, giving a definition of the terms advocacy services and independent. I do hope that the Minister will be open to this argument, and I move Amendment 189.
Thank you very much. I now invite the Minister to speak to Amendment 125 and other amendments in the group.
Okay, Convener, I'll speak to my amendments 125, 126, 127 and respond to Patrick Harvick's amendments 189, 190 and 191 and Claire Adamson's amendments 192 and 193. The purpose of amendments 126 and 127 is to place the Tribunal under a duty to issue a copy of any wrongful termination order to the local authorities with which the landlord is registered. The effect of these amendments is to further join up decisions made against the landlord by the Tribunal with the broader regulation of landlords. Local authorities will be able to take these orders into account when considering a landlord's fit and proper person status under landlord registration. Amendment 125 is a minor technical amendment to clarify the drafting so that it reads immediately before. With regards to Patrick Harvey's amendments 189, 190 and 191, at present there's absolutely nothing to stop a former tenant seeking assistance from persons providing independent advocacy services when the former tenant is making an application for wrongful termination. These organisations, as Patrick Harvey outlined, provide an excellent service, but they can do this without specific provision allowing third-party applications. They can already provide as much help as they wish and can even represent the tenant at the tribunal. But due to the nature of the application, it's unrealistic to think that an application can be made without any or detailed input from the former tenant. And if the tenant is to be involved, I see no reason for the application not to be in his or her name, albeit made with as much or as little assistance as from a third party who wishes to provide it. Otherwise, we would end up in a situation where an application could be made against the tenant's wishes. The application relates to the tenancy that a particular person had, and it should surely be his or her choice whether or not that tenancy is referred to a tribunal application. In addition, wrongful termination orders are about compensating a former tenant for losing his or her home. Under the bill, the payment is made to the person who makes the wrongful termination application, and this amendment would have the effect of allowing third parties to receive any compensatory payment, and I don't think that would be appropriate. With regards to Claire Adamson's amendments 192 and 193, we heard from a number of tenant representatives' organisations during Stage 1 who voiced concern that the proposed maximum payment to tenants for wrongful termination is not sufficient to reflect the upheaval, removal costs and emotional distress that the tenant is likely to have incurred and incurred needlessly. And while most landlords operate within the parameters of the legislation and comply with their obligations, I know that not all do. I want the wrongful termination order to act as a disincentive to landlords. I don't want landlords misleading tenants or the tribunal in a way that leads to tenants having to leave their homes. Accordingly, I would ask the committee to support my amendments. I endorse Claire Adamson's amendments 192 and 193, and I would ask Patrick Harvey not to press amendments 189, 190 and 191.
Thank you, Minister. I now invite Claire Adamson to speak to Amendment 192 and other amendments in the group.
Thank the convener for the opportunity to speak to the amendment. This is a very complex area in terms of the different values of compensation that can be vary across the country depending on the value of the rent that's involved for people. In all of our deliberations in this bill, it's been about achieving balance and fairness to both the landlords and to the tenant. Mr. Harvey has already eloquently laid out the difficulties of a tenant facing a wrongful termination and the other pressures on them at the time. And I feel that we need to have a level of compensation that makes it worthwhile for the tenants to pursue their rights under the bill and also acts as an encouragement for the very best behaviour of the landlords.
Thank you very much. Can I invite Patrick Harvey to wind up and indicate whether or not he wishes to press or withdraw his amendment?
Thank you, Convener. Well, I was a little disappointed that the Minister didn't see the merit in these amendments. I think no one would dispute that action seeking recognition of a wrongful termination does need to be well informed by the experience of the tenant. But I would take issue with the argument that that means there's no reason that it shouldn't be done in their name. One of the issues that I think the whole committee has been aware of in scrutinising this bill is the vulnerability that some people feel in challenging a landlord who, let's remember, in some places, particularly where there are large commercial landlords, that landlord might be somebody's next landlord as well as their former landlord. You know, to be in a position of challenging that landlord in name does feel very different than having another organisation do that on behalf of the tenant. And I also question whether this is purely about compensation. Clearly, that's a very core part of what this section is about, and it's an important one. But surely we should also be expecting, for example, in looking at the fit and proper person test under the landlord registration scheme, we should be expecting factors to be taken into account, such as whether a landlord has a track record of misleading the tribunal or misleading their tenants. So there is a longer term and a wider public interest in this, not purely a private interest on the part of a tenant seeking compensation. It may be that that in itself raises the potential for other changes that might be proposed at stage three. But for the time being, I would like to press Amendment 189.
Okay, thank you very much, Mr. Harvey. The question is that Amendment 189 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
No.
We are not agreed. There will therefore be a division. Those in favour of Amendment 189, please show. Those against Amendment 189, please show. Okay, the result of the vote on amendment number 189 is yes, 0, no, 6. There were no abstentions. The amendment is therefore not agreed to. I call Amendment 125 in the name of the Minister, already debated with Amendment 189. And I invite the Minister to formally move.
Moved.
The question is that Amendment 125 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The question is that Section 47 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
I call Amendment 190 in the name of Patrick Harvey, already debated with Amendment 189, and I invite Patrick Harvey to move or not move.
Not moved.
Thank you. I call Amendment 191 in the name of Patrick Harvey, already debated with Amendment 189, and I invite Patrick Harvey to move or not move.
Not moved.
Thank you.
And good afternoon. Thank you.
Thank you very much for your attendance this morning, Mr. Harvey. The question is that Section 48 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? I call Amendment 126 in the name of the Minister, already debated with Amendment 189, and I invite the Minister to formally move.
Moved.
Thank you. The question is that Amendment 126 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
I call Amendment 192 in the name of Claire Adamson, already debated with Amendment 189, and I invite Claire Adamson to move or not move.
Moved.
Thank you. The question is that Amendment 192 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are agreed. The question is that Section 49 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are. I call Amendment 127 in the name of the Minister, already debated with Amendment 189, and I invite the Minister to formally move.
Moved.
The question is that Amendment 127 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are. The question is that Section 50 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are. I call Amendment 128 in the name of the Minister, already debated with Amendment 85, and I invite the Minister to formally move.
Moved.
Thank you. The question is that Amendment 128 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Thank you. I call Amendment 129 in the name of the Minister, already debated with Amendment 21, and I invite the Minister to formally move.
Move.
The question is that Amendment 129 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
I call Amendment 130 in the name of the Minister, already debated with Amendment 85, and I invite the Minister to formally move.
Move.
Thank you. The question is that Amendment 130 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are. The question is that Section 52 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
I call Amendment 193 in the name of Claire Adamson, already debated with Amendment 189, and I invite Claire Adamson to move or not move.
Moved.
Thank you. The question is that Amendment 193 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The question is agreed. The question is that Section 53 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We now move on to death of tenant, and I call Amendment 142 in the name of the Minister, grouped with Amendments 143, 143A, 144, 194, 145, 146, 195, 196, 197, 198, 147, 148, and 149. And may I point out that Amendment 194 preempts Amendment 145. And can I invite the Minister to move Amendment 142 and speak to all amendments in the group?
Convener, the bill currently provides that where a sole tenant dies, either a bereaved partner may inherit the tenancy or an executor of the tenant's estate must bring the tenancy to an end. These intended amendments are to ensure that if there is no one to succeed the tenant, the tenancy will end without need to appoint an executor. The effect would be if the tenancy is terminated in the death of the tenant, unless there is a partner with a succession right to inherit the tenancy. I listened closely to stakeholders' evidence on this during stage one, and during my own appearance at committee, I stated my intention to bring forward an amendment at stage two to ensure if there is no one to succeed the tenancy, that the tenancy will not end. That's because in considering the issue further, it became clear that the tenancy not ending on the death of the tenant may disadvantage both the landlord and the deceased tenant's family. Any monies left in the deceased's estate could be considerably reduced if it took the executor a while to terminate the tenancy. Also, if the tenant died intestate, the landlord would be sitting with an empty property that they can't relet until such time that the sheriff appoints an executor and the executor subsequently terminates the tenancy. This, convener, is still my intention, but having considered my amendments further, I would like to withdraw them at this stage so that I can consider further the process by which succession will work, and that would mean asking Claire Adamson to withdraw her amendments at this stage as well.
Thank you very much, Minister. Can I invite Claire Adamson to speak to Amendment 143A and other amendments in the group?
Thank you, Convener, and I thank the Minister for her commitment to take this forward to stage three. I think it's a very important principle that we do take forward in all of this. We've been very keen to emphasise that it is very much a family home, and it's someone's home that we're talking about. So in circumstances where there's a sibling, a carer, or a younger person in the family, a child who could succeed the tenancy, I think it's important that those rights are respected. And I will choose to withdraw my amendments given the commitment of the Minister to look at this at stage three.
Okay, thank you. Minister,
withdrawing confirmation.
Do you have anything further to add and to confirm that you are withdrawing?
Sorry, Convener, I'm withdrawing with all the amendments, the amendment at this stage, but the policy intention is clear and we will come back with a process for succession rights.
Can I just have the agreement of members that they are content for the Minister and Claire Adam, first of all, the Minister to withdraw her amendments.
Aye,
we're agreed, and can I have the agreement of the committee that they're content?
Question is at section.
Okay, can we? The question is that section 54 be agreed to. Are we agreed? Thank you. I call amendment 143 in the name of the minister, already debated with amendment 142. And I invite the minister to move or not move.
Not moved.
Thank you. I call amendment 144 in the name of the minister, already debated with amendment 142. And I invite the minister to formally move. Sorry, to move or not move.
Not moved.
Thank you. The question is, I call amendment 194 in the name of Claire Adamson, already debated with amendment 142. And I remind members that if amendment 194 is agreed to, you cannot call amendment 145. Can I invite Claire Adamson to move or not move?
Not moved.
Not move. Okay, the question is that, I call amendment 145 in the name of the minister, already debated with amendment 142, and I invite the minister to move or not move.
Not moved.
Thank you. The question is, I call amendment 146 in the name of the minister, already debated with amendment 142, and I invite the minister to move or not move.
Not moved.
Not move. The question is that section 55 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? We are agreed. I call amendment 195 in the name of Claire Adamson, already debated with amendment 142, and I invite Claire Adamson to move or not move.
Not moved.
Thank you. I call amendment 196 in the name of Claire Adamson, already debated with amendment 142, and I invite Claire Adamson to move or not move.
Not moved.
Not moved. I call amendment 197 in the name of Claire Adamson, already debated with amendment 142, and I invite Claire Adamson to move or not move.
Not moved.
Thank you. I call amendment 198 in the name of Claire Adamson, already debated with amendment 142, and I invite Claire Adamson to move or not move.
Not moved.
I call amendment 147 in the name of the minister, already debated with amendment 142, and I invite the minister to move or not move. I put the question that section 56 be agreed to. Are we agreed?
Yes.
We are agreed. In that case, we now move to tribunal powers, which is, and I call amendment 131 in the name of the minister, grouped with amendment 132, and I invite the minister to move amendment 131 and to speak to both amendments in the group.
So, amendment 131 gives the tribunal the same jurisdiction that the sheriff courts would otherwise have had to deal with civil cases arising from a private residential tenancy. The effect of this will be to ensure the tribunal has jurisdiction for all civil disputes arising from the new tenancy, which would otherwise have fallen on the sheriff. This puts the private residential tenancy in the same position as existing tenancy types and allows the parties to use the more accessible forum of the tribunal. Criminal cases will continue to be dealt with by the sheriff courts as usual, and this amendment does not affect the jurisdiction that the Court of Session has in relation to landlord and tenant matters, such as judicial review. I'm talking now on Amendment 132, Convener. All private landlords are required to register with the local authority in whose area the let property is situated under Part 8 of the Antisocial Behaviour, etc. Scotland Act 2004 to ensure that they are fit and proper to be letting houses. Amendment 132 provides that whereas a result of proceedings before it, it comes to the tribunal's attention that a landlord is not registered with the relevant local authority, the tribunal will be under a duty to notify the local authority. The tribunal must tell the authority the landlord's name and address and the address of the property for which he or she is the landlord. The effect of this will be to enable local authorities who have responsibility for administering landlord registration to take enforcement action against a landlord who is unregistered. I move amendment 131.
Thank you very much, Minister. No members have indicated they wish to speak. Do you have anything further to add?
Nothing further.
In that case, the question is that amendment 131 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are agreed. I call Amendment 132 in the name of the Minister, already debated with Amendment 131, and I invite the Minister to formally move.
Moved.
Thank you. The question is that Amendment 132 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? We are agreed. We now move on to overlooking minor errors in documents. I call Amendment 133 in the name of the Minister in a group on its own, and I invite the Minister to move and speak to Amendment 133.
Amendment 133, Convener, inserts a new section into the Bill which provides that any minor errors in the document specified will not invalidate the document unless the error materially affects the effect of the document. The effect of this will be to ensure that the new tenancy works well in practice, as we don't want tenants and landlords to be penalised for minor errors which do not distort the effect of the document. We want a system which is user-friendly and capable of taking a common-sense approach. I move Amendment 133.
The question is that Amendment 133... I take it you have nothing further to add, Minister?
Nothing further.
The question is that Amendment 133 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Thank you. The question is that Section 57 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
I call Amendment 148 in the name of the Minister, already debated with Amendment 142, and I invite the Minister to formally move.
Moved.
The question is that Amendment 148 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? I call Amendment... Are we all agreed?
No, that...
Sorry.
He's reading out the wrong one.
Okay, the question is that Amendment 148 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
It was indicated earlier that the Minister wasn't going to move the amendments in that section.
We believe that the Minister has moved Amendment 148. Is that...
Not moved.
Beg your pardon,
can we just get clarity from the Minister that she's not moving?
Right, can I just confirm, Minister, that you're not moving Amendment 148?
No, it's consequential in the previous amendments that I've already
So Amendment 148 is not moved. Okay, I call Amendment 149 in the name of the Minister, already debated with Amendment 142.
Not moved.
Minister, to move or not move? Not moved. The question is that Amendment 100... Is it Schedule 4? Sorry, my apologies. The question is that Schedule 4 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? The question is that Section 58 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
I call Amendment 138 in the name of the Minister.
Is that one agreed?
Sorry, 134 in the name of the Minister, already debated with Amendment 21.
Moved.
Can I invite the Minister to move or not move?
Moved.
The question is that Amendment 134 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The question is that Schedule 5 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The question is that Section 59 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
I call Amendments 135, 136, 137 and 138. All in the name of the Minister and all previously debated. Can I invite the Minister to move Amendments 135 to 138 on block?
Moved.
Can I ask whether any member objects to a single question being put? In that case, the question is that Amendments 135 to 138 are agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The question is that Section 60 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
I call Amendment 139 in the name of the Minister, already debated with Amendment 21, and I invite the Minister to formally move.
Moved.
Thank you. The question is that Amendment 139 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
I call Amendment 140 in the name of the Minister, already debated with Amendment 21, and I invite the Minister to formally move.
Moved.
Thank you. The question is that Amendment 140 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The question is that Section 61 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
I call Amendment 141 in the name of the Minister, already debated with Amendment 21, and I invite the Minister to formally move.
Moved.
The question is that Amendment 141 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The question is that Section 62 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The question is that Section 63 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The question is that the long title be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
That ends Stage 2 consideration of the Bill, and that ends our business for today. I now close this meeting of the Committee.